6.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
No bail for Sam Bankman-Fried, the FTX founder, remanded to prison until February. U.S. federal prosecutors charge SBF with 8 counts, and the SBF indicted by the SEC. It's all straight ahead this morning. I'm Dwight Strawn, and this is Morning Blend. Wake up.
Wake up, it's a new day. It's the start of the start of a new way.
You know that this
is the start of the end of the old way. Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day.
Good morning again, Bahamas. It is Wednesday, December 14th, 2022. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Again, I'm Dwight Strawn. In a moment, Chester Robards will be joining us. Also this morning, we're going to be talking with a musician and artist who is doing some wonderful things for the community and has a special event coming up as well. We'll get all the details about that and what he's been doing. And later, our twice-monthly series with A-Squared SBDC. That's the Access Accelerator Small Business Development Center. We're going to be meeting a couple of the honorees at their MSME Awards. We'll be talking with them and about their companies this morning. That's all straight ahead. But first, it's time for The Overnight, the latest breaking news from while you're sleeping, and the top national and international headlines this morning. In the overnight, Chief Magistrate Joyanne Ferguson Pratt denying bail for Sam Bankman-Fried after hearing hours of arguments by lawyers, remanding him to the Bahamas Department of Correctional Services until February 8th of next year. Bankman-Fried, wearing a suit with no tie, appeared stoic when the magistrate gave the decision. His parents and other supporters, who cried during some portions of the hearing, were silent as well. The former CEO of FTX, which is one of the world's largest cryptocurrency exchanges, that relocated its headquarters to the Bahamas last year, appeared in court after he was arrested on Monday on a provisional warrant. The United States is seeking his extradition. Bankman-Fried, also known as SBF, telling the chief magistrate that he will fight extradition. In an indictment unsealed yesterday, prosecutors for the Southern District of New York allege that Bankman-Fried conspired with others to commit wire fraud, commodities fraud, securities fraud, and money laundering. Chief Magistrate describing the charges as high-powered financial charges. Shortly after 4:30 p.m. yesterday, Ferguson Pratt ruled on a bail application made by Bankman-Fried's lawyer, Jerome Roberts. She said that she was of the view that SBF was a flight risk and that he should remain in custody. She said any conditions that she could set for bail could not satisfy the risk of Bankman-Fried's flight. She asked Bankman-Fried to... she told him that she was remanding him to the Department of Correctional Services until February 8th. He will appear before Magistrate Shaka Serville at that time. The chief magistrate made a note that once at the prison at Fox Hill, Bankman-Fried should be seen by a doctor. She allowed him to speak with his lawyers and relatives before he was taken to prison. Shortly before 6 p.m., after the sun disappeared from the sky, intermittent rain poured down. Bankman-Fried was escorted into a blue Ford SUV and taken to prison. Just 24 hours before that, he was a free man in his Albany penthouse in southwest New Providence. Meanwhile, as we said, the United States Securities and Exchange Commission charging the former FTX CEO with defrauding investors. The complaint from the SEC alleging that from at least May 2019 through February 2022, Bankman-Fried engaged in a scheme to defraud equity investors in FTX Trading Limited, the crypto asset trading platform on which he was CEO and co-founder. And at the same time, he was also defrauding the platform's customers. The SEC saying that Bankman-Fried raised more than $1.8 billion from investors, including U.S. investors, who bought an equity stake in FTX, believing that FTX had appropriate controls and risk management measures. Meanwhile, FTX Bahamas' liquidators are seeking the dismissal of a Chapter 11 bankruptcy petition of FTX Property Holdings, which purchased over $250 million worth of real estate in the Bahamas. The liquidator is noting in a court filing that FTX Property Holdings is a Bahamian corporation that does only one thing, own real property located in the Bahamas. It says that all of its known assets and creditors are located here, and it has no connection whatsoever to the United States. It has no assets here, no creditors, and it never has done any business in the U.S. It was requesting the court that the court was not the best forum to resolve the issues of the case. So the case is essentially the liquidation of hundreds of millions of dollars worth of Bahamian real estate, and it would be extremely difficult, if not impossible, to administer that liquidation in a U.S. court. In other news, responding to claims of union busting by Bahamas Public Service Union President Kimsley Ferguson, Minister of State for the Public Service Pia Glover-Roll saying that the ministry has mirrored a pay package against the BPSU's agreement that it is willing to sign. She says she didn't see where that would constitute union busting, and that they're willing to come to the table and sign if the BPSU is. And five dilapidated properties in downtown Nassau have been demolished over the last 6 months as part of efforts to revitalize the downtown area. That's according to Tourism Investments and Aviation Minister Chester Cooper. He says they expect to continue the process where there is non-compliance, and he says they're committed, the government, to the enhancement and improving of downtown. He says there are short-term preliminary things that they're going through and going to do with the ministry. And the man accused of killing a man at his home on Thatch Palm Avenue back on December 7th, formally charged with murder, 20-year-old Shamar Hepburn of Cambridge Lane appeared before Magistrate Kendra Kelly, charged with the murder of 28-year-old Eric Pyfrom. According to police, Pyfrom was stabbed to death at his home after he got into an argument with another man. Hepburn was not required to enter a plea to the murder charge and was remanded to the Bahamas Department of Corrections until February 27th. He was advised of his right to seek bail in the Supreme Court. Overseas, Ukrainian authorities saying they thwarted a Russian attack on Kyiv and the surrounding region today as their air defense system intercepted and destroyed 13 explosive-laden drones, although wreckage from some of them damaged five buildings. No casualties were reported. The attempted strikes underlined how vulnerable Ukraine's capital remains to the regular Russian attacks that have devastated infrastructure and population centers in recent weeks, mostly in the country's east and south. But they also highlighted Ukraine's claims of increasing efficiency in intercepting weapons, something that Patriot missiles from the U.S. may soon help boost. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky, in a brief video statement calling them terrorists, said the terrorists fired 13 Iranian-made drones and that they were all intercepted. Such drones have been part of the firepower along with rockets, missiles, shelling mortars, and artillery as Russia targets power stations, water facilities, and other public utilities. And China's National Health Commission scaling down its daily COVID-19 report starting today in response to a sharp decline in PCR testing since the government eased antivirus measures after daily cases hit record highs. A notice on the commission's website said it stopped publishing daily figures on numbers of COVID cases where no symptoms were detected, since it was impossible to accurately grasp the actual number of asymptomatic infected persons, which have generally accounted for the vast majority of new infections. The only numbers they're reporting are confirmed cases detected in public testing facilities. This poses a key challenge for China as it relaxes its COVID protocols and its zero COVID policy, with mass PCR testing no longer obligatory and people with mild symptoms allowed to recuperate at home rather than in one of the field hospitals that became notorious for overcrowding and poor hygiene. In sports, back after a two-year hiatus, the Father Marcin Peters basketball tournament has returned to action. Champions were crowned in five divisions at the 34th tournament Tuesday at the Kendall Isaacs Gym. Securing a win in the senior girls division was the CV Bethel Senior High School Stingrays. They took down the Sierra Walker Senior High Knights 31-26. Trinity Bodie poured in 11 points in the championship game and came away with the MVP award. She did most of her damage in the second half, scoring 8 points and included 5 points in the final quarter. Leading the way for the Knights was Shantique Stewart, who scored a game-high 13 points in the loss. And a 13-0 run to start the game was all that Jordan Prince William Falcons needed to control the game against the Telio School Cherubims in the junior boys division. They led wire-to-wire in a dominant 53-26 win. Falcons' Michael Munnings walking away with the MVP award, dropping in 15 points in the win. In another GSSA basketball matchup, the H.O. Nash Junior High School Lions, they took care of the C.H. Reeves Junior High School Raptors 46-51 in the junior girls division. Leela Bain was the MVP. She was a one-girl wrecking crew as she poured in a team and game-high 44 points. None of her teammates scored more than 1 point. C.H. Reeves was led by Ricara Beadle with 20 points. In the primary school boys division, the Harbor Island All-Age School took the trophy. They won 34-21 over the Freedom Baptist, scoring 12 points in the first quarter and another 12 in the fourth quarter. And it was a dominant performance from Telios in the primary school girls division as they took down the Temple Christian School's 18-3. Telios did most of his scoring in the first half, scoring 16 points. You can read more in today's Guardian Sports section. And from World Cup soccer, Lionel Messi clutching his left hamstring and appeared to grimace, immediately spreading panic through the soccer world, but he, especially among Argentines, was their superstar, their idol, injured? Was it going to have to come off early in the World Cup semifinals? No, no such luck for Croatia. Messi was back up and producing perhaps the best performance of his record, tying 25 appearances at the World Cup, leading Argentina to a 3-0 victory over Croatia Tuesday that set up a meeting with either France or Morocco in Sunday's final. Messi is back in soccer's biggest match on his mission to win the game's greatest prize for the first time. At 35, he could hardly be playing any better. Again, France and Morocco playing today. That's sports, and that's the overnight. Time for your first look at weather. Any weather for today, we've got a stationary front draped over the islands that continues to weaken while high pressure builds behind the front. Moderate to large swells will continue to impact the islands for the next few days. Hazardous beaching and boating conditions will continue due to long period northeast to easterly swells affecting the islands. Boaters are urged to exercise extreme caution and beachgoers and swimmers strongly discouraged from entering the water. For all areas today, we're looking at partly sunny and breezy conditions with a few isolated showers, mainly near the frontal boundary. Becoming fair and breezy tonight with isolated showers possible. For boaters, again, we've got a small craft advisory in effect due to ocean swells. Winds east-northeast to east-southeast at 15 to 20 knots, occasionally falling to 10 to 15 knots. Seas 4 to 6 feet with building up to 6 to 9 feet offshore, mainly along Atlantic exposed shorelines and moderate to large swells. 72 degrees right now in Nassau under fair skies. We're looking at highs getting up to around 82 Fahrenheit, 28 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down about 64 Fahrenheit, 18 Celsius. That's your first look at weather this morning. We'll have an extended outlook and look at the tropics coming up after traffic in just a bit. This weather check brought to you by BWF. BWF pre-Christmas blowout sale and tent sale going on now, up to 50% off, well, about to start Friday, December 16th and Saturday, December 17th. Huge savings on toys, Christmas supplies, Junkanoo, craft, kitchen, and outdoor cooking supplies and appliances, and a whole lot more. The BWF pre-Christmas blowout sale and tent sale Friday, December 16th and Saturday, December 17th. BWF, we're more than just our name, at number 13 Wilton Street. Call 394-0004 or 6, BWF. Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day. It's time for break, but when we come back, we're discussing the day's top stories right here on Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9, your home for fresh news and smart talk all day.
How important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services. From click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options, we're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches. Fidelity, we're good.
The holidays are a time for reflection on the year past, reconnecting with family and friends, and indulging in brand new experiences. No matter what your holiday may bring, at Reb, we want to remind you to do it together. Play together, watch together, be together. Take time this Christmas to connect with the people and things that really matter. And let Reb take care of home for the holidays. Merry Christmas, Bahamas!
This Yuletide season, start a new Christmas tradition by joining Bahamas Faith Ministries by donating toys, gifts, and school supplies for the Hope for the Holidays Christmas promotion. Hope for the Holidays brings joy and happiness to the faces of children without at least one parent because they're serving time in prison. This Christmas, give hope for the holidays and let the children of incarcerated parents experience a real Christmas. They open presents, eat a meal, and spend time making new Christmas memories. Hope for the Holidays gives incarcerated parents the opportunity to have their kids blessed with gifts and lifelong memories, giving them a newfound joy and motivation to make the necessary changes in their lives to be a positive and supportive role model for their kids. Toys, gifts, and funds for Hope for the Holidays can be donated at the Miles E. Monroe Diplomat Center. Hope for the Holidays Christmas promotion, proudly sponsored by Guardian Media.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
Wake up. It's a new day. Wake up. It's a new day. It's the start of the start of a new way. You know that it's the start of the end of the old way. Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. We're streaming live on guardiantalkradio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas Channel 969 and BTC Flow Channel 612. You can tweet us at Morning Blend 969 or facebook.com/morningblend969. Text us 422-4796. Standard text rates apply on the Guardian Radio text line powered by BTC. Once again, I'm Dwight Strawn. In a moment, Chester Robards will be joining us. We'll give you the phone numbers for you to call in just a bit. Coming up this morning in our 8 o'clock hour, we're going to be talking with Dion Cunningham. He's a very talented musician. Many of you are familiar with him. He's doing a lot in the community, though, man. He's got a special event coming up. We're going to get details about that later in Morning Blend Business. It's our twice-monthly segment with A-Squared SBDC, the Access Accelerator, and we're going to meet a couple of their honorees for their micro, small, medium enterprises. They had awards a few weeks ago, and we're going to talk with two of their honorees and clients and find out more about their businesses. That's all straight ahead. But let's begin with what else is in the news. And in the news, before we get into all the alphabet stuff, you know, SBF, SEC, FTX.
CZ.
That's right. FTT, all that stuff. And the SCB.
CFTC.
What? CFTC. Which one is that one?
The one of those financial watch.
Oh, really? Okay. It's just a lot. It's a lot. Chester, welcome, by the way. And before we get, I just want to say this is in the sports today. I got a shout out to Lila Bain with C.H. Reeves. This is really impressive. In the Father Marcin Peters basketball tournament. Leading her team, the C.H. Reeves Junior High Raptors, to win over the H.O. Nash Lions. The score was 51-46, but she scored 44 points.
Whoa. Wow.
44 points.
That's insane.
None of her teammates scored more than 1 point. They need her with the L.A. Lakers or the Miami Heat. Oh, God. Yeah, but, man.
Oh, yeah. Congratulations.
Impressive.
That's impressive.
Lila Bain. Great stuff. Keep up the great work there. And the other team members need to pull up their socks.
Pass it. Just pass it to her.
just get the ball to Lila no matter
Give
what.
Give her the rock.
Yeah. But, hey, look at that. That is something else. Okay, yeah. I mean. And the other team scored. So, I mean, well, I don't know what's going on with her team members, but. Good stuff there.
That World Cup.
Yeah.
Who you got today?
I don't know. I think it's gonna be France though.
Yeah, likely.
Yeah. But
even though I'm
blind. Underdog.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, it'll be great for them to defeat their former colonial masters. But yeah, you know, always root for those folks.
You mean to Africa?
Up. Yeah. Well, everybody to up. Beat the ones who
France hates
you.
When you say it, but I mean it's two African teams playing each other, really. wait for
oh
it.
Oh boy.
Wait for it.
That's funny. I was gonna say something terrible. Let me not do that. But that's a good one. Okay. Anyway, but yeah, I'm sure you're gonna be watching, we'll be watching. It's been exciting. I'm not the biggest soccer fans. But it's been
very exciting.
It's been
cool.
Football for those who don't like to say soccer, and the penalty kicks. I told you before. I think yeah. that should be a sport. Just penalty kicks. Nah. I'd watch that.
Yeah, it would get boring after.
You think so? Yeah. I don't know. And then you gotta, you know,
you need the drama that leads up to it.
Make the goal smaller.
No.
Yeah. And then
can't you see it's already hard to get the ball in?
It's really make it even worse. So that would juice up penalty kicks, you know.
Gotcha.
But anyway, so of course, the big story all over the world. Everybody's talking about this. SBF. Sam Bankman-Fried. And a dramatic day yesterday. Moving so quickly. And our Travis Cartwright-Carroll writing about it in today's NASA Guardian. This line here is really quite something. And you think about this in the imagery. Just 24, this is all yesterday, and 24 hours before what happened yesterday evening, just 24 hours before that, SBF was a free man at his Albany penthouse in southwest New Providence as he was making his way to the Bahamas Department of Corrections, known as the Fox Hill Prison, as many say, Fox Hell
right.
Prison. My God, what a dramatic turn of events there. And for more on what happened in court, and then we've got so much. We told you about a little bit of this yesterday as it was breaking while we were on the air about the SEC and then the federal prosecutors, what they were saying as well. It was just flying at him from everywhere yesterday in the Bahamas, in the UK, courts all over debating stuff and people issuing press releases left, right, and center. What a day. But take a listen to what happened in the court yesterday for Sam Bankman-Fried in this report from our Jared Higgs.
FTX's former CEO, Sam Bankman-Fried, widely known as SBF, was denied bail today as he appeared before Chief Magistrate Joyanne Ferguson-Pratt on a provisional warrant. SBF had indicated that he planned to contest his extradition to the United States and hoped to get bail. However, the Albany resident was remanded to the Bahamas Department of Corrections. The day started with SBF being whisked into court through a back door, inside court. A representative of the U.S. government immediately argued that Bankman-Fried isn't entitled to apply for bail based on the Extradition Act and the country's extradition treaty with the U.S. On the other hand, attorney Jerome Roberts, who represents SBF, argued that bail is a fundamental right, pointing out that persons charged with the worst offenses are still entitled to apply for bail. Later in the day, Chief Magistrate Joanne Ferguson Pratt ruled in Bankman-Fried's favor, saying he had a right to apply for bail. In making that bail application, SBF's lawyer argued that he had ample opportunity to flee while he held his U.S. passport for the last few weeks. He argued that he is a fit candidate for bail, given that he is a permanent resident of the Bahamas with extensive real estate holdings. On the other side, Franklin Williams, appearing for the U.S. government, argued that Bankman-Fried is a flight risk and suggested that he has ties to jurisdictions that don't have extradition agreements with the United States. Ultimately, Ferguson Pratt sided with Williams and the prosecution and remanded SBF. Other issues came up during the hearing, such as concerns over Bankman-Fried's access to medication while in custody. His lawyer revealed that he takes medication for depression and insomnia. Bankman-Fried's parents also identified themselves in court. While they looked nervous at times, they smiled at one another when the proceedings turned to a discussion on the possibility of a cash bail. At the end of the hearing, a crying SBF hugged his parents. SBF will return to Magistrates Court on February 8th. On that day, he'll appear before Magistrate Shaka Serville. Reporting for the Guardian News Network, I'm Jared Higgs.
Boy, oh boy. Okay. Quite something there. I don't know. I mean, normally if you're in Magistrates Court, you are allowed to apply in the Supreme Court to bail. Will that be what happens here? It hasn't been stated. I haven't seen it. But that's usually the case. But yeah, well, quite something there, hey? We can get your reaction to that. Let's hear what you have to say before we get into some of the other matters. 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. Again, you heard some of the arguments in that report from what the lawyers are saying, that he wasn't a flight risk, that he had, right, all this time, ample opportunities to disappear. Many wonder why he was still around here. Yeah. He had enough money still to get on a private plane, helicopter,
I always wonder
or something.
If he thought nothing would happen. I mean, he spoke as if it was a possibility.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if he thought that that his new home would also turn on him. I don't know, or if that's even a fair way to characterize what has happened. Right, you break the law allegedly, yeah. And this is what happens. But yeah,
he had a lot. He's smart apparently, and he's had a lot of smart people around him. I'm sure he was under no impression that nothing would happen.
Mm-hmm. The lawyers really tried. They're trying. They're saying that the police already have his passport. So where could he have gone? Yeah, February 8th.
It's a long time to be
Christmas
up that way.
New Year's. My goodness. All right, so a couple text messages before we move on to the other topics. This person says, Dwight, have you seen OAC's tweets relative to the SBF fiasco? More alphabet soup, eh? That's
AOC.
AOC, right? That's the same. Yeah, they changed it, AOC. The congresswoman, right?
Mm-hmm. Alexandra Ocasio-Cortez.
Mm-hmm. No, I actually don't pay much attention to stuff she says.
She pronounced the Bahamian wrong. And then I heard that. I caused everybody else to.
She had to apologize for that, apparently.
Oh, did she?
Yeah. But no, I didn't see it. But I heard. Mm-hmm. The statue says, Messi is so impressive.
Messi was pretty good yesterday.
Mm-hmm. This text here, 1 minute you're on top of the world, next minute you're down in the gutter. Such is life. Look at it this way. They probably placed him in the new building. I don't think the new one's finished yet, but they said he's going to be in the sick bay, the medical
right,
area.
For the moment.
I don't know how long he can stay in there, but This person says here, because of his alleged, let me change it, criminal involvement, the Bahamas government should immediately revoke his status. He's not a Bahamian citizen. I will see how much integrity the government has in deciding what to do with his status.
Citizen? Was he made a citizen?
He's a permanent resident.
Permanent resident.
But you're saying revoke that revoke too. Well, this one says here, I'll go out on a limb and say SBF doesn't want to end up in the hands of the U.S. and that certain Bahamians really don't want to see SBF in the hands of the U.S.
I mean, he's facing a list of charges that are worth some time in prison.
My goodness. My goodness. This person says, hey, why preferential treatment in the handling of the SBF court case? Backdoor, no cuffs, restrictions on news reporters? I don't know of any of, well, the backdoor definitely. But when he was leaving court, it appears his hands were, really? Yes, they were cuffed. They were cuffed as he was leaving, as he's being escorted to the prison. And I don't know about restrictions on news reporters. What restrictions?
I don't know.
Okay. But yeah. And the texture, this is an incorrect text. I'm going to read it so people can know that this is not the way to see this. This texter says the PLP strikes again with their scandalous involvement in these things, and it continues to be monumental, I guess. But no, this is nothing to do with that. Stop. This would have happened no matter what. And it would have happened. Yeah, that has nothing to do with that at all. Come on now.
No.
It's just
the company did come here before the PLP was in power.
They did. And it was just, the whole world was fooled.
Yeah.
The whole world was fooled.
Yeah.
Right? Everybody's scrambling now. Can you imagine all those millionaires who lost money, the people who were endorsing this, all of the commercials? They had a Super Bowl commercial. Nobody believes that a clownish company that isn't properly run could afford a Super Bowl commercial. They got a whole stadium in Miami named after them, right? This is your friend's little period scheme. Wow. Couldn't be.
You got Steph Curry. You got the Shark.
My God, man.
You got everybody endorsing you.
Yeah. So everybody was thinking something else. As we've heard, it wasn't what it seemed.
And Mr. Wonderful went back on what he was saying. He thinks Sam's a good guy now. Maybe he's going to go back.
He might be a good guy, but it has nothing to do with it. Right? I mean, messed up here, big time.
Yeah.
Playing around with people's money.
Yeah.
Let's take some calls, and we'll get to some more of the charges. We'll get into that. And the court matters back and forth with what's happening in the U.S., what's happening with the Securities Commission here, and why this is a major back and forth and tug of war, it seems. But let's hear what you have to say. Good morning, caller. You're on the air. Okay. Let's take that other call. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Golly days is Stark and Weiss along with you on Chester Dwight.
Good morning. Morning.
We need justice, law, and order in the Bahamas. But I want to ask you a question. Do you think Mr. Wonderful going to cause us as a Bahamian, according to all those good things he had said,
no,
in the eyes of America, that we all are immature people?
Who are you calling Mr. Wonderful? Are you talking about who are you calling Mr. Wonderful?
Fred Mitchell.
What?
Dwight, you know something?
Oh,
you
boy.
I don't know how to understand you, but I'm not going to try to understand you.
I feel the same way. We're on the same page. We're on the same page, Raymond. We're on the same page. We're on the same page. Okay. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
We thought you might have been talking about the Shark.
Oh, my Lord. Okay. And then, wow. Okay. Some more text. I can't recover. 323-6232. 325-4316. 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. This person says here, has our government or system laid out any charges against SBF as yet? I don't think so. We are apparently relying on the U.S. charges. The Bahamas needs to levy its own charges. And the whole world was not fooled. Just a few greedy bunch, that's it. Well, okay, maybe. People who were anxious to get in on what they thought was going to be the next big thing.
Right.
And a whole bunch of people have been around telling us that this is the next big thing, and if you don't get on this, you are an antiquated dinosaur, and you are a loser, and you don't know anything. Crypto is the future. Yeah. And young, bright minds like this guy who wears shorts to a massive international press conference, that's the type of new thinking that we need. And so a lot of people got blinded by the light.
Yes.
And
I couldn't remember his name, but Mr. Wonderful is Kevin O'Leary.
Kevin O'Leary, yeah.
That's who we were talking about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, certainly I've never heard of Fred Mitchell being called Mr. Wonderful. Maybe his friends do. I call him that. I don't know. But I'm not aware of it. But
you mean in the mirror?
Hmm? Look where you're going. Okay. Anyway, but he is a wonderful person, sure. But Mr. Wonderful, I'm not too sure. But okay.
Yeah, I don't think he has that moniker.
Right. What do we know? This one says, when I look at my returns from the Iraq port development, I feel... Oh, no. Okay. There, I wasn't supposed to read that one on air.
Good thing you didn't go any further.
Oh, my gosh. Wow. I really do need to read these carefully before I start to read them. Have you seen AOC's Twitter and House questions? She is really putting it out there that the government chose a strange time to arrest FBF the day before he was scheduled to testify before a congressional hearing. She also is painting the picture that the government is protecting SBF. Wow.
Whose government?
Must be this one. Oh, dear. Okay.
Fraud in shorts and T-shirts?
Mm-hmm. What?
Someone said Financial Times headline.
What? What's it say?
Fraud in shorts and T-shirts. Mm. The case against the FTX founder.
Why we got to be judging people in shorts? I mean, even though I was just now. But still... I don't expect a headline like that from the Financial Times.
Yeah. Mm. What do you know about Silicon Valley and their dress code?
That might be the dress code. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Hey, good morning, Dwight. Good morning, Chester.
Morning. Good morning.
Hi, good morning to those who wake up in the land of the living. Once again, I hope you had something hard on your chest. But how is the government, Mr. Strawn, protecting Mr. Freeman? How is it?
Freed.
Because you don't expect the financial crime unit of the country to go and arrest Mr. Sam unless they have a warrant. It's fair enough to say, right? Well, let's be real, Dwight. There were only allegations, all right, about Mr. Sam. So the financial crime unit couldn't go and arrest Sam unless they had a warrant. And now they have a warrant, whereas the United States decides to extradite him. But needless to say, Dwight, let me ask you and Chester something. Do you honestly think, as I understand, this is one of the most, or the most high-profile case ever in this country?
Is it?
But, huh?
I don't know. Anyway, okay. Yeah, it's high-profile, definitely.
It's one.
Yeah, one of them. High. Sure.
One. Mm-hmm. Right? But what I'm asking, right, let's be realistic. You think now any judge that sits on the bench or any magistrate going to grant that man bail? Never. Never. You know something, Dwight? You always say lawyers. Yes, they have to make a living. They have to make a living. They have to survive. Right? But lawyers know within themselves, that they're fighting a losing battle. They could apply to the Supreme Court, they'll not come back with the ARC. He going to the U.S. Because right now, Dwight, what the agencies and the departments and the courts that are focused upon Mr. Sam, you think they could give him any bail in the Bahamas and give him bail to make the Bahamas look bad? And if I was the Bahamas government, I wish I could, whenever I get a chance, talk to Mr. Ryan and Mr. Monroe.
Attorney General Ryan Pinder.
Get him out of this country because he's a bad name for this country.
Mm.
He's a bad reflecting, Dwight, and I'm not talking about government, but I don't care who the government was. He's a bad reflecting for this country because you know why? Every day of our lives, as we open our eyes, either the New York Times or some kind of tabloid or media going to be talking about the Bahamas.
Mm.
And they're going to be starting saying this thing about the Bahamas, calling us this, calling us that. Get him out of this country and your lawyers. And right before I go, that's one of those same lawyers. You know, it's so funny. You need to do your research. Who representing the same man, Sam, represent a well-known Bahamian person who was extradited, and he couldn't even do nothing. Stop wasting time and let that man go. Go.
Okay.
Go now, Sam, like ASAP or this country.
Okay. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Well, this text here, give your boy two nights at Fox Hill. He will be pleading to go to the U.S. Maybe one.
So,
change that story today.
They said, he wasn't in the place.
Mm-hmm.
Ain't put him in the place yet.
Right.
Well, when he see the bucket in the corner, then he'd be like, wait a second now. I didn't sign up for this.
Well. This person says, don't worry, the truth will surely come out, and you all we'll see, since you all don't believe Bahamian corruption was involved. Okay. People having a good laugh with Brayman this morning. Okay. Brayman for the gold, that was the best one yet. Okay. This one says here, sounds like you both feel sorry for SBF getting a crib in DOCS, the Department of Correctional Services. Why? Does it sound like that? I mean, this is a sad story. It's a tragedy that something apparently that some saw as promising could end like this, and a lot of people lost a lot of money. Apparently, this is So, I mean, should we feel happy for people being sent to prison?
Some people.
I don't know. I mean, it's not like... I mean, don't get me started.
Even murderers don't face some of the time he's facing for some of his crimes in the States.
Well, murderers here.
Yeah, certainly.
Right. This one says, I don't wish jail on anyone, but do you think our police gave SBF the famous line, quote, come, you lock up? No, I don't think they did that. All right. This one says here, what is his foolishness about SBF's next court appearance in February? Get him out of our country ASAP. This guy needs to be extradited within the next week. We are playing serious fire by keeping him in our prison and country. Another one says here, while we watch the U.S. doing all the heavy lifting in this whole fiasco, it would be nice to see a political party start promoting the importance of FOIA, the Freedom of Information Act, and campaign finance laws, even if only to pretend we're serious about changing the rep of the Bahamas. Sadly, local folks are mashing call messengers and missing the message.
Why do they think him being here physically or not would change anything? I don't understand. Get him out of here because of the reputation? That already mash up.
Wow. Is it only with the accusations about campaign finance? Is it only in the U.S. or is it here as well?
What do you mean?
He's been charged with campaign finance violations.
Here?
I mean, do you think it involves here as well?
No, I don't, because
we don't really have any laws. But I mean, what do you think? Would it be? Could it possibly have been?
I don't think so.
I don't know. Okay. This one says here: where is the Prime Minister? Why is the media? Why isn't the media putting any pressure on him? This is Brave Buddy, really. Tell AOC she shouldn't talk because this same SBF funded the Democrat Party, and that she's also complicit. I wouldn't even listen to her. Maxine Waters, funded? Elizabeth Warren, and more, they only put it on a show.
Did they get funded?
You mean them directly?
Yeah.
I don't know. The Prime Minister issued a statement. You want more? Okay. The only thing I feel is for people that the dude swung out of their money, get that out of our country, he needs to get lost in jail. Okay. One more call, and then we're going to get into some of the charges. Good morning, caller on the air.
Sorry, this morning.
Doing well.
Personally, I think the Prime Minister needs not to issue any statement on someone that is being investigated, being charged in the U.S. as far as for extradition. And who's saying that within the next 2 months that he wouldn't be charged by the Bahamian authorities?
Well,
we have to look at this thing as it is, holistically. He is an American citizen, right? Out of California. America asked for his extradition, right? The Bahamas government was the first one that asked that they hold it here in the Bahamas. And the judge gave him until 2 months to go back to court. I think personally he'll be charged with the Bahamian authorities on some charges that they have to look at pretty closely. Okay? Let's just give it some time. And the worst thing the Prime Minister could do right now is make a statement on this issue.
Mm.
Right?
Okay.
It's not his portfolio to make a statement on that. Have a nice day.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. All right. So let's look at some of the other charges. So, as we said, it was the SEC, Securities and Exchange Commission, and federal prosecutors. Everybody just all over the place with this yesterday. So, our Jasper Ward writing about this. Again, we told you about this yesterday as it was breaking while we were on the air. But the United States Securities and Exchange Commission yesterday charged former FTX CEO Sam Bankman-Fried with defrauding investors from the Bahamas-headquartered cryptocurrency giant. The SEC saying in a complaint, quote, from at least May 2019 through November 2022, Bankman-Fried engaged in a scheme to defraud equity investors in FTX Trading Limited, the crypto asset trading platform of which he was CEO and co-founder, at the same time that he was also defrauding the platform's customers. Bankman-Fried raised more than $1.8 billion from investors, including U.S. investors, who bought an equity stake in FTX, believing that FTX had appropriate controls and risk management measures. Oh, boy. Unbeknownst to those investors and to FTX's trading customers, Bankman-Fried was orchestrating a massive years-long fraud, diverting billions of dollars of the trading platform's customer funds for his own personal benefit and to help grow his crypto regime or empire. The SEC said Bankman-Fried, who was 30 years old, portrayed himself as a responsible leader in the crypto community, adding that he touted the importance of regulation and accountability. It said Bankman-Fried told the public, including investors, that FTX, which he co-founded, was both innovative and responsible. The SEC saying, quote, customers around the world believed his lies and sent billions of dollars to FTX, believing their assets were secure on the FTX trading platform. But from the start, Bankman-Fried improperly diverted customer assets to his privately held crypto hedge fund, Alameda Research, LLC, and then used those customer funds to make undisclosed venture investments, lavish real estate purchases, and large political donations. Telling you that timeline is very interesting. I think it should be examined very closely about here as well. But anyway, okay. Bankman-Fried hid all of this from FTX's equity investors, including U.S. investors, from whom he sought to raise billions of dollars in additional funds. He repeatedly cast FTX as an innovative and conservative trailblazer in the crypto markets. He told investors and prospective investors that FTX had top-notch, sophisticated, automated risk measures in place to protect customer assets, and that those assets were safe and secure, and that Alameda was just another platform customer with no special privileges. The SEC said these statements were false and misleading. It said, in truth, Bankman-Fried exempted Alameda, which he also co-founded, from the risk mitigation measures and provided it with significant special treatment on the FTX platform, including a virtually unlimited line of credit funded by the platform's customers. It said, quote, while he spent lavishly on office space and condominiums in the Bahamas and sank billions of dollars of customer funds into speculative venture investments, Bankman-Fried's house of cards began to crumble. When prices of crypto assets plummeted in May 2022, Alameda's lenders demanded repayment on billions of dollars of loans, despite the fact that Alameda had, by this point, already taken billions of dollars of FTX customer assets, it was unable to satisfy its loan obligations. Bankman-Fried directed FTX to divert billions more in customer assets to Alameda to ensure that Alameda maintained its lending relationships and that money could continue to flow in from lenders and other investors. The SEC claimed that Bankman-Fried continued to misappropriate FTX customer funds even as it became clear that Alameda and FTX could not make customers whole. Through the summer of 2022, he directed hundreds of millions more in FTX customer funders to Alameda. Which he then used for additional venture investments and for loans to himself and other FTX executives. Amid all of this, according to the SEC, Bankman-Fried continued to make misleading statements to investors about FTX's financial condition and risk management. It said, quote, even in November 2022, faced with billions of dollars in customer withdrawal demands that FTX could not fulfill, Bankman-Fried misled investors from whom he needed money to plug a multi-billion dollar hole. His brazen multi-year scheme finally came to an end when FTX, Alameda, and their tangled web of affiliated entities filed for bankruptcy on November 11th, 2022. It said Bankman-Fried will continue to engage in the acts, practices, transactions, and courses of business outlined in the complaints unless he is, quote, permanently restrained and enjoined. Bankman-Fried was arrested, as you know, at Albany, his Albany penthouse, shortly after 6 p.m. On Monday, the Office of the Attorney General said that his arrest followed receipt of formal notification from the U.S. that it has filed criminal charges against him and is likely to request his extradition. Wow. Wow, that's a lot.
Mm-hmm. A lot was going on.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think Reuters published an article yesterday explaining how they opened up a window for Alameda to just use FTX funds unabated.
Mm.
It was just, it was literally just like a switch in the code.
Yeah. My goodness. Okay. So let's read your text messages and then we're going to take a break and then come back with more of what's happening. What the Securities Commission here, the challenges they're facing. They issued a very long statement yesterday about the issues they're having with the court proceedings going on in the U.S. and how the new FTX CEO has been misrepresenting what's going on. And their issues with all of that. We'll get to that in a second. So let's read these text messages before we go to the break. This one says here, I'm now remembering how the Prime Minister was saying not to jump to conclusions and be careful. And now SBF gets arrested and no bail. Him being here is a shield to others. Dear journalists, I know you can't say what you actually think, and you're likely right in your thoughts.
It's probably true.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
Well, I'll tell you one thing.
Oh boy.
I'll tell you one thing. Huh. SBF was doing a ton of interviews all over the place. Yeah. New York Times, Forbes.
And admitting to many of the things that he's being accused of.
Yeah.
Right?
Twitter geeks. Like, so, all kinds of people.
Yeah.
One local house got an interview
mm-hmm.
with him, even though I'm sure many requested, including me,
mm-hmm.
and was denied.
Oh, you were denied?
Denied,
like, outright?
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, outright.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because there are probably some questions that they don't want to be... No, it's not that.
You don't think so?
There's some yeah. questions that they don't want answered here. Mm. Who knows what they are?
Well, this person says, to answer your question about whether it involves, political donations here, that's exactly what AOC is insinuating. Yeah. Well, that timeline would imply that, probably. Let's hear from our political parties here.
We already tried to hear from them. What else could they say?
Mm-hmm. They talk about all kinds of other things, though.
What else would
they
say?
Aren't talking about that.
Yeah, they were. They're mm-hmm. saying no, aren't they?
Who said that?
Didn't they say no?
You heard that?
Wasn't it asked?
Mm. okay, this person says here.
Or maybe each individual person was asked and said they didn't personally receive.
Right. I don't understand this. Oh, no, I'm not going to read that. Okay. What? Okay, no, this is getting all speculation now. Is SBF is charged in the Bahamas, would this override his extradition issues, and would that keep him here in the Bahamas?
You think he's going to be charged here?
Well, the Securities Commission can't get a case together, it seems. They're trying to investigate, and they're having some issues.
Everybody's locked out. Right? Liquidators.
Liquidators are having SCB, issues. Everybody's having issues.
Can't figure it out.
Yeah, all right. Let's take a break, and when we come back, we'll get into the challenges that, again, the Securities Commission is facing.
It's interesting, isn't it?
And what they're saying about the new CEO, and more on all of this behind-the-scenes drama and what we're likely to see over the next few days. There's a lot more to talk about. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Stay tuned, folks. We'll be back in just a bit.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM.
.744 the time. Time for your first look at traffic for this morning, brought to you by RBC. Make this Christmas whatever you want it to be with an RBC personal loan. In your real-time traffic this morning, here's what's happened. We've got a Prince Charles Drive seeing some heavy traffic in a number of spots, especially near Elizabeth Estates and as you approach the Fox Hill Road intersection, but especially as you make your way toward Beatrice Avenue, westbound this morning. You're going to be seeing that heavy traffic in front of you. And then again, well, it's building now on when Prince Charles turns into Robinson Road, just west of Soldier, but not as bad as we've seen at this time some mornings this week. The issue is going to be making your way to Beatrice Avenue at this hour. Elsewhere, we've got Eastern Road, seeing some heavy traffic, but just west of Fox Hill and before you get to Johnson Road, westbound. Then we've got a Milo Butler Highway from Fire Trail roundabout all the way up to Tawny Gloom's Darling Highway roundabout, and building traffic westbound on Tawny Gloom's Darling Highway to that roundabout with Milo Butler Highway. Glasson Road also busy for you just north of Fire Trail, and Carmichael westbound on the way to Coral Harbor Road you're going to be seeing heavy traffic there. That's what we're looking at so far. That's your real-time traffic and your Morning Blend traffic alert brought to you by RBC. Apply for a loan with RBC at rbc.com/Caribbean/loan and don't pay until February 2023. And we've got another check of your weather for today, brought to you by Sherwin-Williams. We've got a stationary front draped over the islands that continues to weaken while high pressure builds behind the front. Moderate to large swells will continue to impact the islands for the next few days. Hazardous beaching and boating conditions will continue due to long period northeast to easterly swells. And boaters are urged to exercise extreme caution. And beachgoers and swimmers strongly advised to stay out of the water. For today, for all areas, your forecast calls for partly sunny and breezy conditions with a few isolated showers, mainly near the frontal boundary, becoming fair and breezy tonight with a chance of isolated passing showers. Small craft advisory remains in effect due to ocean swells. Temperatures getting up to around 82 Fahrenheit, 28 Celsius today. Overnight lows tonight getting down to around 64 Fahrenheit, 18 Celsius. In your extended outlook, high pressure across the area will build on Thursday, ahead of a cold front that's expected to move into the northwest Bahamas by Friday. That powerful low-pressure system far out in the Atlantic will continue to generate long-period swells affecting the islands, especially Atlantic coasts. So for tomorrow, Thursday, partly sunny and warm with a chance of isolated showers, becoming fair and mild at night with a chance of isolated showers. Friday, partly cloudy with scattered showers in the northwest Bahamas, sunny and warm in the central and southeastern islands, becoming fair and mild at night. That's your Morning Blend weather check, brought to you by Sherwin-Williams. Sherwin-Williams Paints wants to make your holiday a splash jollier. November 21st through December 23rd, come deck your walls with color by stopping into either the Tawnique Williams Darling Highway or Prince Charles Drive location and take advantage of their Christmas sale of up to 20% off. And when you spend $100 or more, you enter to win prizes like hotel stays, boat excursions, interior designer consultations, and more. So stop on in to win. Sherwin-Williams Bahamas, find color in every day.
Chenet's Chesapeake Road Christmas Wonderland is open under the Big Tent. Get your Christmas trees in pink, frosted, green, or white in a variety of sizes. Musical Christmas LED and laser lights. A large variety of tree ornaments. Lighted angels and Santa tree toppers. Bright and lively colored Christmas balls in all sizes. Garlands, wreaths, tree skirts, stockings, and lots more. Add flowers, picks, and decorative mesh to brighten up your home or office this holiday season. And don't forget the toys at Chenet's Chesapeake Road. Check our selections online at www.chenet.com.
This Christmas season, stream with faster speeds. The unforgettable things we all have to see. Share every memory. Link up for Christmas. Link up with BTC. We are family.
BTC will make this festive season fun and fast with BTC's fiber internet. Sign up and BTC will give you 1 month free or go postpaid and get unlimited Facebook and WhatsApp.
Link up for Christmas. Link up.
Power on the holidays this Christmas with Custom Computers. We have everything that everyone wants to see under the tree. Laptops, iPads, AirPods, Apple Watches, Bluetooth speakers, and more. Find gifts for every reason this Christmas season at Custom Computers. Visit us on Patton Street in Palmdale, opposite Liquid Courage, or in Caves Village through the Blake Road entrance. The best Christmas has to offer is right here at your one-stop shop, Custom Computers.
Earning zero interest on your savings at the bank? With as little as $100, you can start earning interest on your money while you're sleeping, eating, or standing in line at the bank with the CFAL Savings Express Plan. Ready to invest? Start by putting $1,000 into our mutual funds and earn interest there too. Because at CFAL, your interest is our interest. Visit CFAL.com to start now. CFAL. Growing wealth for future generations of Bahamians.
Again, and Colombian Emeralds International wants to show our appreciation to you, our valuable customers, with our annual Customers Appreciation Day sale, 50% plus an additional 15% off. On Monday, December the 19th and Tuesday the 20th from 9 a.m. until 6 p.m. at their Rawson Square Bay Street location. There'll be prizes and surprises every hour. So come and celebrate this holiday season with some sparkle and give the gift of memories that will last a lifetime with Colombian Emerald.
Do you want a chance to win one of five Yamaha Kryptonite scooters? Do you like the great taste of Frito-Lay chips? Well, all you have to do is purchase chips like Lay's, Doritos, and Cheetos at your favorite grocery store, and you can enter to win thanks to Frito-Lay and Island Wholesale scooter giveaway promotion. Want to know more? Join us at Solomon Supercenter December 17th, this Saturday from 1 to 3 p.m. for a chance to play Island Wholesale Shoot and Win game for instant prizes and a chance to win one of five Yamaha scooters. Frito-Lay, distributed by Island Wholesale.
It's the most rewarding time of the year.
Come down to RBC.
Get a loan to buy whatever.
RBC makes it better.
Get a loan and don't pay till New Year.
Make Christmas what you want it to be with a personal loan from RBC. Apply at rbc.com/Caribbean/loan and don't pay till February 2023. Conditions apply.
Get a loan and don't pay till New Year.
Come down to RBC.
Florida Auto Parts can deliver all the auto parts your car will ever need, direct from the USA and from around the world. Florida Auto Parts provides fast delivery on auto parts, and we ship throughout the Bahamas, genuine or aftermarket, new or used, and all for the best price. Call Florida Auto Parts Trusted Parts Rep on WhatsApp at 1-786-772-8777 to save on your next auto parts purchase. Florida Auto Parts, the right parts at the right price.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
We're back here with Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strong along with Chester Robards on this Wednesday morning as we discuss SBF, FTX, all this stuff, everything. all right, so we heard from the SEC is saying, the Securities and Exchange Commission, and federal prosecutors as well. Weighing in on this, the Associated Press reported that the U.S. government charged Sam Bankman-Fried, the founder and former CEO of cryptocurrency exchange FTX, with a host of financial crimes on Tuesday, alleging he intentionally deceived customers and investors to enrich himself and others while playing a central role in the company's multi-billion dollar collapse. Federal prosecutors said Bankman-Fried devised, quote, a scheme and artifice to defraud FTX's customers and investors beginning in 2019, the year that it was founded. He illegally diverted their money to cover expenses, debts, and risky trades at the crypto hedge fund he started in 2017, Alameda Research, and to make lavish real estate purchases and large political donations, the prosecutor said in a 13-page indictment. The 30-year-old was arrested on Monday. He's been charged with 8 criminal violations ranging from wire fraud to money laundering to conspiracy to commit fraud. If convicted of all the charges, Bankman-Fried, referred to by crypto enthusiasts as SBF, could face decades in jail. At a news conference on Tuesday, the U.S. Attorney Damon Williams in New York called it one of the, quote, biggest frauds in American history. And said the investigation is ongoing and fast moving. Bankman-Fried has fallen hard and fast from the top of the cryptocurrency industry. He helped to evangelize. FTX filed for bankruptcy on November 11th when it ran out of money after the cryptocurrency equivalent of a bank run. Before the bankruptcy, he was considered by many in Washington and on Wall Street as a wunderkind of digital currencies, someone who could help take them into the mainstream, in part by working with policymakers to bring more oversight and trust to the industry. Bankman-Fried had been worth tens of billions of dollars, at least on paper, and was able to attract celebrities like Tom Brady or former politicians like Tony Blair and Bill Clinton to his conferences at luxury resorts in the Bahamas. One prominent Silicon Valley firm, Sequoia Capital, invested hundreds of millions of dollars in FTX, sporting shorts and T-shirts to contrast himself with the button-down world of Wall Street. Boy. He was the subject of fawning media profiles, a vocal advocate of a type of charitable giving known as effective altruism, and garnered millions of Twitter followers. But since FTX's implosion, Bankman-Fried and his company have been likened to other disgraced financiers and companies such as Bernie Madoff and Enron. The criminal indictment against Bankman-Fried and others at FTX is on top of criminal charges announced Tuesday by the SEC, which we just went through, and the Commodity Futures Trading Commission. The SEC alleges that Bankman-Fried defrauded FTX customers by making loans to himself, as we just went through. No other FTX executives were named in the indictment, nor was the CEO of Alameda Research, Carolyn Ellison. Also not named in the indictment, Bankman-Fried's father, Joseph Bankman, a Stanford University law professor who was considered an advisor to his son. U.S. authorities say they will try to claw back any of Bankman-Fried's financial gains from his alleged scheme. A lawyer for Bankman-Fried, Mark S. Cohen, saying Tuesday he's, quote, reviewing the charges with his legal team and considering all of his legal options. At a congressional hearing Tuesday, that was scheduled before Bankman-Fried's arrest. The new CEO, brought in to steer FTX through its bankruptcy proceedings, leveled harsh criticism. He said there was scant oversight of customers' money and very few rules about how their funds could be used. John Ray III telling members of the House Financial Services Committee that the collapse of FTX, resulting in the loss of more than $7 billion, was the culmination of months or even years of bad decisions and poor financial controls. He said, quote, "This is not something that happened overnight or in a context of a week. This is just plain old-fashioned embezzlement, taking money from others and using it for your own purposes." Before his arrest, Bankman-Fried had been holed up in his luxury compound in the Bahamas. U.S. authorities are expected to request his extradition to the U.S. Wow, okay. Now, they go on to say in the Associated Press report, Bankman-Fried was previously one of the world's wealthiest people on paper, and at one point his net worth reached $26.5 billion, according to Forbes. He was a prominent personality in Washington, donating millions of dollars to Democrats and Republicans. U.S. Attorney Williams saying Tuesday that Bankman-Fried made tens of millions of dollars in illegal campaign donations. But that was before everything unraveled last month. My goodness. Wow. Okay, so we're going to have a little more from what the new CEO is saying and what the Securities Commission of the Bahamas is saying, with what they're saying is some mischaracterizations in just a bit. Got a lot more to get through on this Wednesday morning. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio. Stay tuned. The news coming up next. Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. We are streaming live on GuardianTalkRadio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas Channel 969 and BTC Flow Channel 612. You can tweet us at MorningBlend969 or Facebook.com/MorningBlend969. Text us 422-4796. And now at 8:21. Time for another check of your weather for today, brought to you by Bahamas First Insurance. Here's what's happening. We've got a stationary front that's draped over the islands now that continues to weaken while high pressure builds behind the front. Moderate to large swells will continue to impact the island chain for the next few days. But we do have a number of special warnings. Hazardous beaching and boating conditions will continue due to long period northeast to easterly swells affecting the islands. And boaters are urged to exercise extreme caution, and beachgoers and swimmers strongly discouraged from entering the water. For all areas today, forecast calls for partly sunny and breezy conditions with a few isolated showers, mainly near the frontal boundary, becoming fair and breezy tonight with a chance of isolated showers. Small craft advisory remains in effect due to those ocean swells. Temperatures today getting up to around 82 Fahrenheit, 28 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down to about 64 Fahrenheit, 18 Celsius. Currently in Nassau, it's about 75 degrees under mostly cloudy skies. In your extended outlook, high pressure building across the area Thursday ahead of a cold front is expected to move into the northwest Bahamas on Friday. And that powerful low-pressure system we've been talking about for days now, far out in the Atlantic, will continue to generate long-period swells affecting the islands, especially Atlantic coastlines. So for tomorrow, Thursday, partly sunny and warm with a chance of isolated showers, becoming fair and mild at night with a chance of isolated showers. Friday, partly cloudy with scattered showers in the northwest Bahamas, sunny and warm in the central and southeastern islands, becoming fair and mild at night. That's your Morning Blend weather check, brought to you by Bahamas First Insurance, still the first and only local insurance company and agency network that lets you buy car and home insurance 100% online. Try it at bahamasfirst.com. All right. And day 24, time for another check of your traffic for this morning, brought to you by RBC. Make this Christmas whatever you want it to be with an RBC personal loan. In your real-time traffic, Tawny Williams Darling Highway seeing some heavy traffic westbound to the roundabout with Milo Butler Highway. Milo Butler Highway, as usual, seeing some heavy traffic on the northbound lanes heading toward that roundabout with Tawny Williams Darling Highway. Fire Trail seeing a bit of congestion on the way to the roundabout that it shares with Milo Butler Highway as well, eastbound mainly at this hour. Gladstone Road looking busy for you just north of Fire Trail on the way to JFK Drive. And Carmichael westbound seeing some building traffic as you head toward Coral Harbor Road. And eastbound as well on Carmichael east to Blue Hill Road, where we're seeing heavy traffic near that junction and just north of Soldier Road. So get over the hill to Independence Drive. Soldier Road and East Street, that intersection looking busy for you. East Street seeing some building traffic northbound just north of Soldier on the way to the roundabout with East-West Highway and Independence Drive. And Prince Charles Drive, heavy traffic as you make your way toward Beatrice Avenue westbound. And again, as you make your way through to Robinson Road between Soldier and Old Trail. Eastern Road as well, just west of Fox Hill. And as you make your way toward Johnson Road. Those are your hot spots this morning. That's your real-time traffic and your morning blend traffic alert brought to you by RBC. Apply for a loan with RBC at rbc.com/Caribbean/loan and don't pay until February 2023. And don't forget RBC's Caribbean Acts of Kindness. This Christmas, let's spread some good together. Share your story of an act of kindness on the RBC Facebook and Instagram pages. And a registered charity of your choice could be selected to receive a donation from RBC. Be inspired. Hashtag RBC give and get. It feels good to do good.
This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful. And since we've no place to go, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. And it doesn't show signs.
We're back here with Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strawn along with Chester Robards. In a few minutes, we're going to be talking with Dion Cunningham about his big event coming up this weekend and about the work that he's doing. We can get into that in just a bit. That's coming up. And later, we've got Morning Blend Business and Access Accelerator, Small Business Development Center. We're going to meet a couple of their honorees at the MSME Awards they had a few weeks ago. So a lot more to get to on this Wednesday morning. Okay, we just want to get through the rest of your text messages and get to what we've been talking about, SBF and what happened yesterday and the back and forth between the new FTX CEO and what the Securities Commission is saying in response to that. Let's do that first, and then we'll get to your text messages. So there's a whole lot going on. Just the charges from different entities and the testimony in the House in the U.S. and back and forth and tug at this and that. It was a lot to keep up with. But take a listen to this report from our Paige McCartney.
Before his arrest last night, Bankman-Fried was scheduled to testify before the U.S. House of Representatives Committee on Financial Services today. That hearing into the collapse of FTX still went on as planned, with new FTX CEO John Ray testifying under oath. He said Sam Bankman-Fried and other executives were grossly inexperienced and unsophisticated individuals who failed to implement virtually any of the systems or controls that are necessary for a company that is entrusted with other people's money or assets.
Some of the unacceptable management practices identified so far include the use of computer infrastructure that gave individuals and senior management access to systems that stored customer assets without security controls to prevent them from redirecting those assets. The storing of certain private keys to access hundreds of millions of dollars in crypto assets without effective security controls or encryption. The ability of Alameda to borrow funds held at FTX.com to be utilized for its own trading or investments without any effective limits whatsoever. The commingling of assets, a lack of complete documentation for transactions involving nearly 500 separate investments made with FTX Group funds and assets.
Well, there's an ongoing rift between the Bahamian-appointed joint provisional liquidators and the new CEO of FTX over access to the company's files and assets. During today's hearing, Ray asserted that there's been no transparency from Bahamian authorities as he leads ongoing investigations.
Unlike the Chapter 11 process, there's no transparency. And we've repeatedly asked them for clarity about what they've been doing. We've been shut down on that.
So from you, you've requested insight as to why this was done from the Bahamian authorities. And the Bahamian authorities, their reply to you was that they did not reply, or they replied and it was unsatisfactory.
They put out statements that it was in the interest of Bahamian creditors, although you know, our view is that it violated the automatic stay in bankruptcy.
And so you have questions that still remain unanswered by the Bahamian authorities that would shed additional light into your investigation if that information was provided?
Yes.
Do you believe that if, at that time Mr. Bankman-Fried was attempting to undermine Chapter 11 cases by expanding the scope, by moving assets to accounts under the control of the Bahamian authorities?
It appears so.
So it appears that he may be working to undermine the scope of U.S. federal bankruptcy law.
That's what it appears.
While the Securities Commission of the Bahamas has hit back against what it referred to as misstatements made by Ray, in a statement, the commission maintained that every action it has taken has been in strict accordance with this country's legislation and with orders made by the Supreme Court of the Bahamas, adding that those actions included securing the transfer of potentially commingled digital assets of FTX Digital Markets and affiliates to a secure location under the authority of an order issued by the Supreme Court of the Bahamas. The commission said it holds those assets as trustee only under Bahamian law, and they will ultimately be distributed to creditors and clients of FTX wherever they may be located in accordance with the court's direction. As for Ray's claim that Bahamian authorities are not being forthcoming with information in a transparent manner, the SCB said it has been Ray who's not been open to transparent communication. They added that, unfortunately, it's been necessary for the Securities Commission to make a request to Mr. Ray's representatives to not obstruct investigations, and that not once has Ray reached out to the Securities Commission to discuss any of its concerns before airing them publicly.
Okay, our Paige McCartney with that report there. Oh, boy. Mm-hmm. That's a lot there. We're getting reaction to this already, and we can take a few more of your messages there, or you can call in really quickly. 325-4316. 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. Okay.
If you listened to that four-hour testimony yesterday, you really deserve a round of applause.
Did you?
Yes.
The whole four? Oh, dear.
Pretty much.
So, I mean, it sounds like, you know, the Bahamas is, I don't know if it's being thrown under the bus, so regulators here, but
well, of
but,
course.
But is they it don't. Entirely, or is it just like pushed near the bus?
Well, it just feels like they don't respect Bahamian law and the way Bahamians decide to do things. Mm-hmm. So that's about it. And you heard that from numerous people in the House yesterday, House of Representatives. Mm-hmm. You heard one guy saying, you know, we need to get this crypto stuff under our laws because it, you know, it can't grow and flourish anywhere else but the U.S. Mm-hmm. Basically what he's saying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Wow. Okay. But also you heard Ray saying that, you know, this, it seems he was saying that the company was in the hands of essentially kids who didn't know what they were doing.
Right, yeah.
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 So it's a bad combo.
Oh, yeah.
Kids who don't know what they're doing and people who aren't regulating the way they're supposed to, perhaps?
Well, I don't think he's talking about regulation. He's talking about the things that happen in the liquidation process and how that process goes.
Mm, okay.
They didn't talk much about how things were before. Mm-hmm. Well, they didn't call the Bahamas his name.
Yeah. But if we did things differently, then the process of liquidation might potentially be different.
We have stuff that they want, clearly, including all of the coins that are being held by the tokens that are being held by the Securities Commission.
Yeah.
You know they want that.
Yeah, I'm sure. Okay. So some messages here. And this one says here, has our government or system laid out any charges against SBF? I think I read that already. I really believe the government was protecting itself by arresting Sam yesterday so he wouldn't appear at the hearing. We tend to feel sad for wealthy or well-off people who go to prison. The gangsters, yes, but not well-to-do individuals. We are a truly backward nation. The U.S.'s SEC has already levied charges against SBF on his operations, mainly in the Bahamas. And our Securities Commission has not said anything related to his offenses. All they are doing is whining and running like a lost child after Ray, the new CEO, with long, irrelevant statements. One of the 40 violations against the Bahamas by the FATF was that we didn't demonstrate that we had the expertise and competence to handle complex cases in the financial services industry. Our jurisdiction is, again, proving them right. Wow. Okay. Boy, another one here. This is a lot. I guess tell the political operatives, I guess you're saying, to take off the gold tints and see the world the way it is. SBF violated a Supreme Court order and was not questioned by the police. He went on a massive media blitz outlining all the things he did. No questioning from the police. But as soon as the U.S. files charges, the Bahamas can arrest him. The police bulletin even states that the crimes that the U.S. charged him with are also crimes in the Bahamas. So no one knew this all this time. Why did it take a U.S. filing to get someone to admit that he committed crimes in the Bahamas? I'm sorry, but this whole arresting him and parading him before the world is nothing more than showboating now that it is clear that the U.S. wants to lock him up. Why did it take charges by the SEC to make the Bahamas government spring into action? Why did this happen on the eve of SBF's scheduled testimony before the U.S. Congress? Now that he has been denied bail and remanded, that completely removes any possibility of him testifying before the congressional panel, at least until February. Furthermore, now that he is in remand, an extradition request would have to now be received. No matter how you look at it, at every turn it appears that the Bahamas is protecting him. Even though he might be in Fox Hill, it's still an advantage for him to be there, more than in the U.S. being made to account for his crimes in the U.S. justice system. Wow. Why would I believe the same Securities Commission who said they never received an email or knew about letting Bahamas withdraw assets? Yikes. Yikes. Okay. Let's take this call really quickly. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Hey, good morning.
Hi.
My question, Mr. Ray, what legal authority does he have other than being the new CEO of the American companies?
Legal authority to do what?
To do what he demanding that our government do for him.
He doesn't have any legal authority?
No, he doesn't. Because he's just the CEO of the company for now.
That's why all he can do is complain.
Exactly. That's why he's making it seem like he's the one in charge of the court matters. When the courts in the Bahamas and the courts in Delaware are the ones who are in charge. And the U.S. Congress, they shams. They all of them, both political bodies in the United States got money from FTX. Both political bodies. Some of the same Congress people who are in there who joined the death of the Bahamas, they got money for their campaign. The new Democrat majority leader in the next Congress, he got money, Jeffries. He said he giving his money to charity. See? But at the end of the day, the martyrs are before the court. And people who are saying the Bahamas protecting him by putting him before the court. If you, Fox Hill prison is a hellhole. He won't be there. No Bahamian won't be in Fox Hill prison. So if you get information that some government person do something wrong, you had your chance in court. He had his chance in court yesterday. He could have said, look, I want to make a statement. He hasn't done it. So why we always believe that people protecting government officials? We always believe that people protecting government officials, and they're willing to go to forks and hell over to protect government officials. That make any sense? He's an American citizen. If the United States asks to extradite a Bahamian or anybody in this jurisdiction, everybody has the same right to go to court to fight the extradition. That doesn't mean that you are not going to get be sent to the United States. Mm. And because they arrested him right before he was supposed to testify, when he go to court, he could say whatever he wants to say. The same questions what they ask him in the Congress, which don't have no lock-up power. The Congress, the United States, they ain't got no power to lock nobody up.
Yeah.
That's why they can't even lock up Donald Trump, who they claim do all kind of nonsense.
Caller, thank you very much. Appreciate it. Appreciate it. Let's take another call really quickly. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Yes, sir. Good morning to what?
Hi, good morning.
Yes, sir. To your last caller, right? This Congress hearing, right? This isn't about jail time, about a criminal charge. This is about them creating legislation. My question to him and to the Bahamas is what about But what is our hearing, or what are we saying about the DARE Act and the issues of the DARE Act? Specifically, like this guy, this guy that's testifying, he speaks about the lack of independent board in this company. You know, the lack of them are having records. You know what I'm saying? It seems like this DARE Act that we boast about this. You know what I'm saying? It has great issues.
Yeah.
You see, and I think, and this is what we need to address. So,
okay.
You know, thank you.
Thank
and
you
the Bahamas
much.
Seems like, you know, the Bahamas government and this bankruptcy thing is about them trying to make money from it. You know, just from the bankruptcy procedures. That's what I see. Thank you.
Okay. I don't understand that part there.
But to make money off.
Okay. Messages as we go to the break. This person says here, why would anyone respect Bahamian laws? The Securities Commission of the Bahamas is so incompetent. Well, how is it that the U.S. federal government is able to levy all these charges against SBF within this little time with evidence and our Securities Commission? And they said they've been checking on from 2019, right? That's what the Americans are saying. So they've been looking at investigating this for a little while. But our Securities Commission can't come up with a charge. Seems like our authorities want to piggyback off the work of the U.S. This is shameful. Well, this one says, I'm not defending SBF, but how is it that he can't get bail, but murderers can at the drop of a hat? I think it's as simple as that for the accused murderers, but they certainly can get bail, yes. The Bahamian authorities only arrested Sammy because he was scheduled to testify. I don't know if that's true, but the timing is interesting.
Timing was interesting.
Another one here. The reason our authorities waited to move on SBF is because they wanted to be sure that he was touchable. If he was untouchable, they would never have gone after him. Okay. I have no idea what that means, but sure. We're going to leave that there, folks. I'm sure there's going to be many developments today and for the remainder of the week. This is going to be interesting. We're going to take a break, though. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Stay with us.
And my dear, we're still goodbye. As long as you love me so. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.
You can lose a lot of money gambling if you're not careful. That's right. Be sure and pay your bills first. Set aside your savings and know exactly how much you can spend and what you could lose. If you win, you win. But if you lose, you lose. Set a budget and stick to it. Please, be safe and only gamble what you can actually afford to lose. This message is brought to you by the Gaming Board for the Bahamas.
It's the most rewarding time of the year.
Come down to RBC.
Get a loan to buy whatever.
RBC makes it better.
Get a loan and don't pay till New Year.
Make a
Christmas what you want it to be with a personal loan from RBC. Apply at rbc.com/caribbean/loan and don't pay till February 2023. Conditions apply.
Get a loan and don't pay till New Year.
Come down to RBC.
Power on the holidays this Christmas with Custom Computers. We have everything that everyone wants to see under the tree. Laptops, iPads, AirPods, Apple Watches, Bluetooth speakers, and more. Find gifts for every reason this Christmas season at Custom Computers. Visit us on Patton Street in Palmdale opposite Liquid Courage or in Caves Village through the Blake Road entrance. The best Christmas has to offer is right here at your one-stop shop. Custom Computers.
Mon, Christmas right around the corner, but they still got long gifts to buy.
But BTC got the best postpaid deals from $44.99.
You thinking about signing up for a postpaid plan, do you?
It's easy. You get unlimited WhatsApp and Facebook for free, and it don't come from the data in your package. I sign up for a $64.99 plan, and they give me a free phone. That promotion going on right now.
This Christmas, get great handset offers and unlimited WhatsApp and Facebook for free when you sign up for any postpaid plan. Link up today.
Link up!
Get a merry makeover this Christmas from Scotiabank.
Apply for a Scotiabank loan to win a home renovation.
This Christmas, unwrap the celebration.
$3,000 for your home, new lamp, new decor, new couch that you
own. Win a $3,000 home goods gift card when you apply for a Scotiabank loan this Christmas. We're giving you the gift of a low interest rate and up to 2 months with no payments. Plan the perfect Christmas with your Scotiabank loan. Use it for any purpose, plus benefit from flexible payment terms. Apply for a Scotiabank loan now to enter to win a merry home makeover.
It's the time of year again, and Colombian Emeralds International wants to show our appreciation to you, our valuable customers, with our annual Customers Appreciation Day sale, 50% plus an additional 15% off. On Monday, December the 19th, and Tuesday the 20th, from 9 a.m. until 6 p.m. at their Rawson Square Bay Street location. There'll be prizes and surprises every hour. So come and celebrate this holiday season with some sparkle and give the gift of memories that will last a lifetime with Colombian Emeralds.
Florida Auto Parts can deliver all the auto parts your car will ever need, direct from the USA and from around the world. Florida Auto Parts provides fast delivery on auto parts, and we ship throughout the Bahamas, genuine or aftermarket, new or used, and all for the best price. Call Florida Auto Parts Trusted Parts Rep on WhatsApp at 1-786-772-8777 to save on your next auto parts purchase. Florida Auto Parts, the right parts at the right price.
We are back here with Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strawn along with Chester Robards. And this morning we're changing gears. We're going to be talking about a special event that's coming up, but also a very special person who is doing some wonderful things. And Dion Cunningham is his name. Many of you know him as a performing artist, but he's a lot of other things. And he's been telling us about that. He's a very busy young man. But welcome to the show. Great to have you with us.
Dwight, thank you for having me. Good morning, Bahamas.
All right. So tell us about the stuff that you're telling us. So we know people. I think a lot of people know you for music, performing, but you're doing a lot more than that.
Yeah. I mean, try to wrap up my biography in 60 seconds. I am born the eldest son of Bishop De'Anza Cunningham and Edris Cunningham, and thankful to be brought up under their upbringing. I attended Thelma Gibson Primary, St. Augustine's College. Then I went off to university at McAllister, where I studied biology and music. And then later
that's
on...
an interesting combination.
Yeah, no, mm-hmm. but it'll come full circle. I came back home, taught in our primary and secondary ed systems for 5 years, where I was teaching music. And then the last 10 years, from 2011 to 2019, I've lived in the D.C., Maryland area, what they call the DMV, where I would have got a master's degree in music from the Peabody Institute of Hopkins, Johns Hopkins, and then a PhD at the University of Maryland. And I came to know that I am the first Bahamian in our country's history to achieve the Doctor of Musical Arts degree. So thankful and grateful. And since I've been back home in 2019, we've all dealt with the pandemic, but I've been fortunate to serve at the University of the Bahamas as an assistant professor in the music department, as well as the School of Education.
Wow.
And so in a nutshell, that's what I've been doing. Performance-wise, I've had wonderful opportunities. Carnegie Hall debut in 2016. Adventures in the Arts, which is an outreach program of mine that is based here in the Bahamas, was also started in 2016. Mm-hmm. And excited that in 3 days we get to do our 7th production in 6 years for the community, but also as an outreach to children's homes, all of the children's homes on the island, as well as taking the show into the Simpson Penn and Wilhelmina Pratt Centers for girls and boys where their youth are incarcerated. So
that's amazing.
Yeah.
So I should really be calling you Dr. Cunningham.
Call me Dion. No problem.
But okay, so tell us about the outreach program. How did that come about? And why did you feel that was important?
Absolutely. So as a graduate student, I was still in school in 2016. When I thought about the landscape, the artistic landscape of the Bahamas, what I noticed was a little bit of a lack. And that lack had to do with our art scene, our cultural scene, did not really target children and youth. Mm-hmm. I could not think of one artist, one event that was cultural or musical in nature that really targeted children and youth. Mm-hmm. And so as a student in my PhD program, I said, I want to create an experience that is curated and created for an audience of kids. And so in 2016, I decided that I would create what was then called Adventures in Western Art Music. Mm-hmm. I'm a concert pianist. And so for me, I also wanted to selfishly introduce the next generation to what it is that a Bahamian could do that is not necessarily done locally.
Right.
And so what I did was instead of opening it to the general public, I did it very secretly. I just wrote schools and I said, I want you to come. This is a field trip experience. And it's not just music, but we will, what is what I call edutain the students. So education and entertainment hybridize. And Dwight, in 2016, we had over 300 K-12 students across 20 schools.
My goodness.
And since then, 6 years later, we've impacted over 2,000 K-12 students alone through Adventures in the Arts, edutainment experiences, workshops, etc. And so for me, now it has grown to where it includes connections between performing arts and visual arts. So for instance, Alan Pacino Wallace, I don't even need to talk about his resume.
Right.
He is involved in the program because wonderful. He brings the visual art component. Dance, we have an international cast. Daphne Lee from the Dance Theater of Harlem is now involved in our programming. But not to take away from our local musicians, we have wonderful stars. Dwight, I'm not gonna put you on blast, but you play an instrument where you're going to get the opportunity to see the finest violinists and cellists that our country has produced. Mm-hmm. Cameron Pratt and Romel Scherer, who are also involved. And then vocalists. We know Bahamians love singing. And we have some of the finest in Danielle Lee, Chara Jones, and Rashad Cunningham, who is my cousin as well. But it's going to be an amazing experience. 5 narrators, 4 film creators. It is a hybrid of film, concert, dramatic arts, theater.
Yeah.
It is a totally unique experience that we provide and have had the opportunity to produce for the last 6 years.
Okay, so you said a lot. clear this up, because, I mean, you mentioned it. So, yeah, I played instruments, and I remember when I was younger, I don't know if it was like this for you, Chester, but it seemed like everybody was playing an instrument.
Absolutely.
Everybody was in music school at some point and doing this. Is that the case today? It just doesn't seem like it is, but maybe I'm detached, but are we seeing what we used to see even 10, 20 years ago?
I think one of the challenges that I think all artists face is the fight for attention. Because there's so many, we live in 2022, there's so many things that our children and youth can be exposed to. So in a sense, you are absolutely correct. There might not be the attention to having your son or your daughter be involved in a musical or an artistic experience. Mm-hmm. And I think that's quite sad, and it's quite detrimental, because here's why. Music is one of the only subject areas that really touches all of the intelligences. And this is me putting on my education hat. When we think of intelligence, we think of verbal linguistic. If you're smart, that means you can write and you can read and you can take a test. But there are many other intelligences. There's spatial, there's mathematical, there's kinesthetic, there's interpersonal, there's intrapersonal, there's naturalistic. And music is the only discipline. The arts is the only disciplines that actually touches all of them.
Yeah.
So when you develop as a musician, as a performing artist, as a visual artist, you are developing your brain in a way that doesn't develop if you're not involved. The brain actually looks different in a child that is under musical instruction than a child that doesn't.
Wow.
The auditory cortex, which is responsible for our ability to listen, is developed 130 times stronger in students, children and youth that study music than those that don't. Mm-hmm. What does that mean for us as a society? Mm-hmm. Do we listen very well as a country?
Oh, boy.
I mean, I don't want to open that can of worms, but I'm
know the answer to that.
I'm advocating for the importance of being involved in a musical experience, particularly in those formative years.
Yeah. Well, so people are going to say, hey, it costs a lot of money to go to music classes, to go to music school, to buy instruments, and this is, you know, things are tough these days. What do you say to people who bring up that excuse?
If you care about your child's, your son, your daughter's brain development, you will involve them in a musical experience. It is the only discipline where the chief skill is the development of listening skills.
Mm-hmm.
That's all I have to say. And we're thankful that we can, you know, in our work, we can preach that gospel. The gospel of music is what I call it. My father's going to do the theology side, but the gospel of music to the country.
Is the recorder still a standard instrument? Is that still a thing?
Absolutely. And here's why the recorder is so important. Because one of the interesting things about woodwind instruments is that you develop a sense of breath and oxygen uptake, particularly when you study a woodwind instrument, than those that don't necessarily study woodwinds.
Right.
And so the recorder is a starting point not only to developing great saxophonists and flautists and others, but it really helps to develop a part of human biological development that is absolutely crucial, literally, to life.
Wow.
You got to breathe in order to live.
Okay, that's a very interesting way to look at it.
You laugh at it, but it is a fine
Look at that.
It's a fine sounding instrument if you play it well.
If you play it well, right.
Yeah.
All right, so I don't want to make this an us versus them thing, but is it the same if you learn an instrument versus singing in a choir? Can you develop the brain like you talked about in the same way, or is that something different?
No, it's absolutely the same. Because as a singer, now, as a singer, you are supposed to be, and I put supposed in quotations, supposed to be a musician. And what do I mean by that? It is not just simply a matter of flexing your vocal cords because you have a good tone, but are you listening to the musical elements? Are you developing your dynamic range, your articulation, your ability to read music, your ability to collaborate with others in a musical setting? Are you in touch with your affections? What is it that you're trying to deliver as a vocalist to an audience, whether it be an audience of children or youth or to general public? We understand the value of music, and so a vocalist is particularly well-positioned in order to deliver an experience, because unlike the rest of us, a vocalist has the advantage of words.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you superimpose words with all of the other musical elements, it's really something quite powerful.
Okay, wow. So we're getting some interesting text messages here.
Okay, before you get to the text, I have to ask, what did you do at Carnegie?
Oh, yeah. So I won the, in 2016, I won was a prize winner in two competitions, the American Protégé International Piano Competition, and then I was a third prize winner in the American Prize. And so those two, the collection of those two winnings allowed me to make my Carnegie Hall debut in November of 2016. And so there have been many Bahamian, I'm sure the National Youth Choir has done it, but I don't know of so many pianists that have had that opportunity.
Yeah,
so I'm humbled and grateful for that.
Wow,
and
that's awesome.
And in a way, it presented me to the world, and I'm just super grateful. Yeah, yeah. Pianists go their whole lives wanting that opportunity, and I got it while I was still a student.
That's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. All right, so this person, a couple people saying it too, but there's so little money in it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and so I guess I hope that's not the reason why folks aren't steering their children toward learning instruments, learning music. Yeah. But what do you say to that?
Well, as I can speak as an artist, we need everybody involved in music, because one of the goals of Adventures in the Arts and in my life as a musician is not only just to develop the next generation of musicians, but we also need arts advocates and arts patrons. Mm-hmm. If a child is studying music, their brain is developing in a way that those that don't aren't. But that doesn't mean that they can't transfer those skills into other areas. So, for instance, one of the underreported stories is that doctors, and particularly surgeons, are a village of doctors who actually specialize in the surgical areas are actually musicians. I think it's something like 20%.
Wow. Yeah.
So when you develop...
play a lot of music while they're operating.
Well, I'm talking about the kinesthetic intelligence.
Yeah.
Okay. So the fine motor control that you develop as an instrumentalist is directly transferable to the study of medicine, and particularly surgery.
Okay.
So when we study music, it really opens ourselves to being at a high level in any profession. And I think, and so a physician who was a musician, who's now coming back to the Bahamas and seeing the musical experiences and what can be afforded to their children or their community, I think that's where I want to make the impact. I want to see where people, even outside of music as a profession, get to appreciate it. And if that happens, we won't have an issue with support. Mm-hmm. But I think the issue is a lot of our professionals who are in those higher echelons don't see it as being valuable. And so what I'm hoping through the work of Adventures in the Arts is that we change that narrative for the next generation, that they will grow up, whether or not they become radio personalities, accountants, whatever, politicians, they will remember the musical experience and how important it was to their development, and then by in turn supporting it.
Well, you know who thinks it's valuable? John Canoes. Because a lot of people in the band play instruments, and a lot of young people play instruments in John Canoe bands.
Absolutely. And John Canoe is a wonderful example of the interpersonal value of the interpersonal intelligence that is developed. You have to be in John Canoe. I've never seen it, but I don't think I've ever seen John Canoe being done by an audience of one. It's always it's always a community event. And so there are people say, they're just playing around, goofing off. No, they're developing interpersonal intelligence as a result of being in an activity like John Canoe or a marching band, a concert band, or an orchestra.
Excellent. Yeah. We're going to get some details. I want to give details about the event this weekend in just a bit. Let's take this call really quickly. And they got an interesting text message here. Caller, good morning. You're on the air.
Morning, Dwight. Morning, Chester. Good morning, my cousin, Brother Cunningham.
Hey, what's up?
just wanted to make a very, very quick statement here. Something so profound, and I hope it didn't cross over, just pass over everybody's head.
Okay.
Music. Music is the derivative of math. And you're going to find that a lot of persons who are immersed in mathematics actually do gravitate towards music.
Absolutely.
In fact, music is the universal language.
Absolutely.
And if we could get our children and ourselves, because everything is resonating from music. Everything has rhythm from music. I believe that once we can get that across and get our children really involved in that, it would help them not just from an educational standpoint, but it also helped them from a lifestyle standpoint. Our culture is so important, and it's so and so far, even though junk new is seems to be our prime attraction towards the music, the music and the cultural aspect.
Yes.
I believe that we can get well-rounded people once we get them grounded back towards music and mathematics as a whole. Thanks for taking my call, Dwight.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The musical world is so much larger, and I think that's one of the goals with Adventures in the Arts, is to really expose our community to areas of the performing arts and visual arts that are not necessarily enjoyed in this community. So the reason we collaborate with the Dance Theater of Harlem, for instance, in our work this weekend is because we don't necessarily get to see principal ballerinas on the stage. Mm-hmm. And so that is important for us. It's interesting you talk about music as a universal language, because at the end of October and the beginning of November, I actually was a Chen Yidan Fellow at Harvard University, where I got to teach a course called Music as a Universal Language to masters and PhD students at Harvard. Mm-hmm. And actually, absolutely, that was something that all of my students were able to take away, that music is important for brain and body development. Yeah. Music is important for communication. Music is important for understanding ideas of technology and sustainability, oppression and reconciliation, understanding even just the mundane life. Mm-hmm. And I was thankful for that opportunity. Thank you for reminding me that I actually taught that course at Harvard just a few months ago as a Chen Yidan Fellow. Mm-hmm. One of the greatest experiences of my life.
We'll have to have you back, because I want to talk about the type of music and how that influences your behavior.
Absolutely.
Because certain types of music, I'm not going to say what type, but if I listen to it while I'm driving, you don't want to be on the road with me.
Mm. So you get worse.
Oh, yes. But that's, anyway, we'll get into that today. Let's take this call. Good morning, caller, you're on the air.
Good morning, how are you doing?
Doing well.
All right, good morning to you, guys. I have one of those questions for you, as I always used to say, to my experiences with the music world and the sports world, there are only two things in this world, in this life, that will grab an immediate attention of young people. That is sports and music.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Sports and music are the only two things from life experiences and other organizations to which I'm affiliated. And I would encourage parents, especially who have younger children, to get involved in either of the two, and you could be assured that your children will be very beneficial to themselves, to their parents, and to society as a whole. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Someone's saying here that students are still memorizing their times tables by singing them, and so that
absolutely, that's so interesting you brought that up, because there is not a single child in the world that wasn't exposed to Mozart's melody. Ah, je voudrais de, ah, je voudrais je de maman, and that. So I just spoke a French title. And most of us know that as Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, or mm-hmm. ABCDEFG. Mm-hmm. And so that's a wonderful example of how the power of music to really touch all of the intelligence, to take something as simple as the ABCs and take it into long-term memory.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Has anybody forgotten their ABCs today?
Oh, no.
But yeah, we forget a lot of things, but that's because of the power of music.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
yeah. All right, so this is an interesting text here. I don't know if this is appropriate. This person's asking if you teach personal lessons, you give lessons.
Oh, yeah. I don't do a lot of it, but I do teach a limited number of students. Okay. I'm pretty busy.
But they want to learn from the best. Yeah. All right, so tell us about this weekend. Tell us about this weekend and what's going to be happening.
Okay, yeah. So this weekend, we are doing the encore presentation of Adventures in the Arts, the Christmas edition. It is in our 6 years of existence. It's probably the finest and most creative edutainment experience we've ever done. And so it will be this weekend, Friday, December 16th, and Saturday, December 17th at 7:30. Mm-hmm. Who is featured there? I mentioned them before. Alan Pacino Wallace, visual artist. Daphne Lee from the Dance Theater of Harlem. Jonathan Stirrup, who's a male principal dancer, who's the standard for male dancing in the Bahamas. Ramel Shera and Cameron Pratt, some of the finest string players, certainly the finest violinists and cellists on the island now, and as well as three amazing vocalists, Danielle Lee, Chara Jones, and Rashad Cunningham. What is the experience? All I can say is this. You have to be there to really experience what it is. It is not a concert. It is not a play. It is not a film. It is something that is totally a hybrid of performing, visual, and dramatic, and digital arts in one. We have a team of five narrators, four filmmakers, and a whole host of support staff that really help to bring this experience to life. It is an experience for the whole family. And I would say, box offices are at Logos Bookstore, uh-huh. Customs Computers Caves Village, as well as the venue Christ Community Church. Christ Community Church is located just off Fire Trail Road between Samalo Butler Highway and Gladstone Road. So it's in that area. $35 for adults, $20 for kids. There's an intermission. And I will say, if you can't make it, you really would have missed something.
Yeah.
So I really hope that the Bahamian public really is intrigued, shows up, and yeah, just be prepared to be edutained as Adventures in the Arts really tells the Christmas story in a way that you would have never heard it.
Oh, okay. This is going to be great. And again, it's Friday and Saturday, 7:30 p.m.
Christ Community Church.
Okay. This is great stuff, Dion Cunningham. It's a pleasure talking with you this
morning.
Thank you, Dwight. Great to have you with us. And hopefully you'll be back with us again.
Absolutely. It's my pleasure.
Wonderful. The great work that you're doing. We're very proud of you. And looking forward to this weekend.
All right.
Bye.
Thank you.
We're going to take a break. And when we come back, Morning Blend Business, we're talking with two of the honorees for the MSME Awards from the A Squared SBDC. We'll tell you about all that alphabet soup when we come back. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio. Stay with us.
If you see me walking down the street, bumping my head and tapping my feet, I've got music in my bones. I've got music in my bones. Yeah. We rode the West End Moose and beautiful Cat Island. Oh, high up the pot cake. Then we took them down home. Oh, fee, fee, fi, fo, fo, fum. Look how far we've come from. I've got music in my bones.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Wake up, today. Wake up, it's a new day.
Welcome to Morning Blend Business on this Wednesday, December 14th, 2022. Welcome back to our Morning Blend listeners. Once again, I'm Dwight Strawn along with Chester Robards. And this morning, it's our twice monthly segment with A Squared SBDC. That's the Access Accelerator, Small Business Development Center. And this morning, we are talking with two of the honorees of their MSME Awards, the Micro Small Medium Enterprises Awards that they had just a few weeks back. Very pleased to welcome from Drive Green Rentals, Benjamin Davis, and from the Cookie Caterer, Gregory Cawley. Gentlemen, great to have you with us. Good morning.
Good morning. Pleasure to be here.
All right. So congratulations. How did this come about? What did they tell you about how you became to be honored in this way?
Okay. All right, good morning once again. Benjamin Davis here from Drive Green Rentals. It's actually been a very interesting experience. First got a call and they said, hey, we are doing this inaugural event. We want to highlight micro, small, medium enterprises here inside the country. We want to look at persons who went through this SBDC Access Accelerator program. And they said, for transport on it, and I said, honored, like what's really going on here? And I'll be completely honest with you, it was a little vague in the beginning, and I'm sure Gregory will say the same thing. And we kind of went up there with open minds and said, okay, let's see what happens. We got contacted by the company, I think, that was doing the whole event production. They wanted some video. And,
right.
And we said, okay, well, let's see how this goes. So
yeah, and that's why I let Benjamin go on first, because he said a lot more than I would have said. I found out almost at the last minute, they just told me to show up. They're doing an event. Mm-hmm. They wanted me to show up. Mm-hmm. And so I said, okay, cool. You know, we've had a great relationship. So I said, I'll show up. And on the day of, I got a message said, you know, you're being honored. You're given an award. You get 30 seconds for an acceptance. And I was like, okay, goodness. Well, this is interesting.
Well, there you go.
I said, yeah, good thing I like to go off the cuff. You know, I don't really like to prepare for stuff. So, yeah, that's why I let Benjamin go first because, boy, it was a last-minute thing for me. I literally found out that I was getting an award that day. And so, but it was a great experience. The show was great. The performances were great. And I was honored. You know what I mean? To be recognized. But it was a great, it was an overall great event.
Yeah. Wow. So they didn't want you to back out or anything. So you just come and be surprised.
Surprised me like that one day.
All right. So Benjamin, you got the award for transportation.
Yes.
So tell us about your company, Drive Green Rentals. What exactly do you do?
So Drive Green Rentals is the first and only all-electric car rental company here.
Oh, wow.
In the Bahamas.
I wish I'd known about this before.
Yeah, especially with gas going up so high sometimes, it's really, really nice to have an alternative. So I'll just give you a quick backstory. The project itself started while I was still in school at the University of the Bahamas. And this was one of my senior classes. It was an entrepreneurship class. I studied music and, funny enough, business. Sorry, I supposed to be the other way around. Business and music, but of course you just had on the good Dr. Cunningham.
A theme today.
Just did a concert with him a couple of weeks ago. Oh, but anyway.
Nice.
So I studied both business and music at the University of the Bahamas. And one of my final courses was an entrepreneurship class. And they gave us two options. They said either you do a study on an existing business and say how they can next level, or you come up with your own business plan and something that, you know, you would be interested in presenting. Just, you know, as part of the final project, we're worth, I don't know, maybe 40% of the class or something. There was no final exam. So I said, okay, fine. I'll do this. I've always been into cars. I've always been into technology. I like to work with my hands. I like to be physical with everything. And basically, after going through a couple versions of this business plan and whatnot, my lecturer, my advisor, my business advisor, my parents, and everyone was like, you know something, I think this actually could be something that you could actually really look into seriously and not just have this, you know, end with this class.
Yeah.
And so, okay, I started to look into it a bit more, and I said, okay, well, if I'm going to get into electric cars in the Bahamas, I said, I've watched all the videos, I've read all the papers about how they work in the US and how they work in the UK and how, you know, this is just a new movement. Of course, this is back in 2017 before we had so many on the roads here. Mm-hmm. And so I said, okay, sold my car, took whatever little bit of change I could scrap up as a college student working part-time and whatnot. I can get one of these electric cars. And I got the first one. I even had to borrow a couple of dollars from my dad. And I said, I need to see how this works here on the roads. I need to see, you know, with our current our power infrastructure, with our road infrastructure, do these cars hold up? Is this viable? Because, I mean, yes, it works on paper, but, you know, if I drive the car down, you know, Nassau Street, of course, before it was paved, and, you know, it fall apart before I reach the end of the corner, then it doesn't work.
Mm-hmm.
And after a couple of months with the car, I said, no, this is cool. This is fun. The car was a lot more fun to drive. And Gregory actually doesn't know this, but right around the same time, I believe he got his first delivery car, which was...
I know that, Benjamin. Why you think I know that? I know you were one of my customers from a long time, and I ride up with my Leaf, and you say, nice guy, and you had one too, so I remember.
Yeah, and I said, well, if he's doing deliveries, and he's all on the road all day with this, I said, and people are going to be driving all the road, I said, I this could work. And so really, we spent a while, and we had approached a couple of different investors, and trying to get funding, but of course, with it being such a novel idea, people were like, well, I don't know. I mean, what's an electric car? What can this with rentals? But, you know, they cost so much more than a regular car. You know, how is this going to work as a business model? And it took us a while. And right around the same time, maybe about a year or so into trying to get funding, that's when the SBDC was starting to form.
Mm-hmm.
And I came in, and at that point, I already had business plan already together. I'd already gone through a couple of different investors. So I had this plan already had the holes shot in it, and I'd patched them back up a million times. So by the time I got there, they were like, man, you look like you're ready. And so, I mean, I was one of the first clients who actually was able to get funding through the SBDC, and that really took us to where we needed to start, because I had taken the first car, and I had basically started a rental company with one car.
Wow.
And it's hard to do a rental company with one car. So that was able to get our next set of cars, and we were able to grow from there. And of course, we took a hit with the pandemic being predominantly serving tourism market, but we've bounced back. We kept going through it, and we're here stronger than ever, and we're excited for the next upcoming season.
You started with the Leaf?
Yeah, we started with just one leaf.
Okay. Yeah. And what are you up to now? How many vehicles?
We're just over 10 vehicles. We have a mix of, we actually phased out, moved more to a little bit of the more longer range vehicles. So we're looking, we have some of the Chevy Bolts that came out of the US, and we have a couple of cars we got locally here from through the BYD and whatnot. So we're just trying to, you know, read the market, see what are people into, what works best as a business model, also getting more charging stations installed at locations where persons can, you know, recharge these vehicles if they're not charging at home and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know one of the hurdles was charging stations at hotels. Has that been rectified at all? Have hotels decided to kind of partner and put charging stations around their areas?
All right, so that's actually a great question. When we first started, that was one of our big things. We were like, you know, how do we get all of these people to now sign on to saying, you know, we're going to get charging stations in here? But once we actually got started and really started to rework a little bit of this model, especially through the funding phase, we said it actually makes a little bit more sense to have charging stations at places where people can actually go and spend some time. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we have partner locations like Fusion. So you can go there and you can spend, you know, 2-3 hours easy if you're going to get a movie or get the place it's going to be. So actually try to get people out of their hotels and actually spending money with these, you know, local Bahamian businesses.
Right.
So whether that's, you know, a charging station recently went up in Harbor Bay. So you have all of these shopping complexes that you can go ahead and spend funds at rather than saying, okay, well, I'm going to just spend a day at the hotel because my car is charging. So no, go out, plug in your car, you know, get some Starbucks, watch a movie, you know, eat at a local restaurant, go to the beach, something like that, you know, go downtown. So
I imagine with the average visitor trip being 3-4 days, they could go a whole trip.
Yeah, and we possibly do have, and we do have current customers. I think the longest I've seen, I think we had one customer who was here for almost 3 weeks, and he was so, so proud that he was able to last the entire time. Yeah, he said, oh, really? Yeah, I was driving so efficiently. I was using the regen braking, and I was, you know, and I wow. he made it the challenge of himself to not have the charge at all.
Which vehicle was that?
That was one of the, that was a Chevy Bolt, which had 230-something miles of range.
Yeah. Nice. Yeah.
But interestingly enough, you'll have some people who will literally drive the I'm assuming drive the island circles, because I mean, they left the car and then a day later they're like, hey, I'm looking for a charge station. I'm like, didn't I just drop this car yesterday? Like, how? That's a 7x21.
Wow. I could destroy my battery. I use it.
Really? Yeah.
Press that gas on.
Seriously, you're focusing on the tourist market now. Are you noticing Bahamians are interested, or more and more Bahamians are interested in renting?
We do have quite a few Bahamians, especially in recent, last, I would say, month or two, we've seen a lot more Bahamians who have been interested in, you know, just trying something new, or, you know, wanting to save a couple of dollars while it's people who come in from the islands and whatnot. So, I mean, we work with one or two companies inside the islands. I have a couple of colleagues in, you know, Eleuthera, Exuma, when they come into Nassau, they say, okay, well, I'm looking for, you know, usually I rent cars from so-and-so when I'm in Eleuthera, where do I? And they say, okay, yeah, well, I know this part guy in Nassau, and they'll send us to us. And, of course, most people who come to us, they always come back. So we actually have quite a lot of return customers. Even, you know, I think, I would think that, you know, a trip to the Bahamas would be fairly expensive, and maybe people may come once in a couple of years. But I found out that, you know, I have customers who are here, you know, maybe twice a year, and they're like, oh, no, I always come back to the Bahamas, and I always come back to Drive Green. People like the fact that, you know, you don't have to do that mad dash right before the airport. And everyone knows this when you're heading back to try to catch that flight back to Nassau.
Right.
You're like, okay, where's the gas station? Where's the gas station? And you always end up to the gas station that's 5 minutes from the airport, which is, of course, two times more expensive than any other gas station. And, you know, the fact that we also drop off the vehicle anywhere that you need it. So we do a lot of our drop-offs to the airport, but we also have drop-offs to the cruise terminal, drop-offs to the hotels, drop-offs to the marinas, with persons who just love the convenience of not having to worry about the gas. And, of course, when you need a rental car, chances are you don't have a car. So getting it delivered right to your doorstep kind of gives that extra, you know, everyone says they feel like a VIP when they walk out of the airport and there's an iPad with somebody holding the name that it says welcome.
Wow.
So.
Nice.
Mm-hmm. So how do they say?
What do they say?
Once you go green, what name gasoline?
Wow. Like that. Okay, Chester.
They don't say that.
Chester says that one. And it'll only be Chester going forward. But okay, so how do the prices compare to renting another gas vehicle?
Well, it depends on, I guess, who you're going to compare us to. So we're more or less going up against the, since we're in the tourism market, we're going more or less up against the international franchises. And we're pretty much on par. So our vehicles start at $99 a day. If you want extra insurance, of course, you can add that on and whatnot. But our whole big thing is that there's no hidden and there's no extra fees. Mm-hmm. So I know a lot of times, even when you rent in inside the U.S., you see that big thing, you say, oh, $30 a day. By the time you leave the county, you're like, hold on, how does it cost exactly a day now, you know?
Right.
So our whole thing is that we want to make sure that there's no hidden extra fees. Of course, you're already not paying for gas, so that $99 a day gets you out of the door. So, I mean, when you compare us to, you know, maybe some of the local companies that are, you know, renting the Japanese vehicles, yes, it's a little bit more expensive. But, of course, compared to the international franchises, we're pretty much right inside that same ballpark. Yeah. And like I said, when you get to that final checkout page and you see your price is still $99 a day and you don't see, you know, the concession charge and the license fee and the this fee and the that fee, then, you know, everything's nice and encapsulated all into one nice round number, I guess.
And y'all don't charge for Philip.
No. So, I mean, we always tell our customers, we know it's a new thing, especially from Europe and from Canada. We say, okay, we know you may not be too comfortable with, you know, figuring out how this works. And a lot of times, this person's first time driving electric also. So we explain everything to them. You basically get a quick crash course on the car. We say, okay, well, this is where it shows you how much miles you have left. This is what the percentage is. This is how you're going to plug it in. Mm-hmm. And we have a little map inside the car. There's a map on the website. And we also tell people about the PlugShare app so they can actually see where's the nearest charging location to them. Mm-hmm. And we try to, you know, tell people, listen, you know, even though public charging stations are free, we try to offset that by saying, make sure you support whatever business that you're going to, because of course, you know, they're paying for the electricity, which at the end of the day is still only about $4 or $5 in electricity. Yeah. But as cost is offset by, if you're going in for, you know, let's say, for example, a movie at Fusion or getting a Starbucks coffee or something, you know, that $5-$6 is easily, you know, paid back. So we try to say, you know, don't just, you know, sit inside the car for an hour. The whole idea is you plug it in, you have some fun while you're doing that.
Nice. All right. So, Benjamin, we'll come back to you and ask you about where you're located, how people can rent a vehicle from you, and a whole lot more about electric vehicles, which you've experienced in just a bit. But Gregory Colley, but for those who aren't familiar with Cookie Cater, I don't know where they've been, but tell us about how you got into this and about your business.
Well, my story is nowhere near as elaborate as Benjamin's. A lot of people probably already know my story. Like I said, I was on here before. It's good to be in person. Last time, I think we did virtual. Mm-hmm. So it's good to be here in person. But basically, I'm a sweet mode behemoth like most people.
Sweet mode
behemoth. And so I started, you know, baking cookies from home. I had a job at the time. I was working with a shipping company at the time. Mm-hmm. But I just started, you know, making them from home. And I used to give them out at that time. And people would tell me all the time, you know, you need to sell them. But, you know, if you're employed, you're like, what are you selling it for? You know what I mean? Well, I got fired the next year. And I had my first child on the way. And so I said, you know what? Selling these cookies sound like a pretty good idea. And so I went and created a Facebook page in July of 2012. Back then, we only had two cookies. I was chocolate chunk and oatmeal raisin. So I put the page up, and I started, you know, delivering cookies from door to door. People actually started ordering. And so I would, you know, just deliver. And it was, let's say, 6 years. I went to SBDC after I already opened my first location in 2018. So 6 years going door to door. In 2018, I opened the first one on Mount Royal Avenue with all the funds that I had saved up at that time. And I went to SBDC later that year and joined to open our second location the following year on Carmichael Road. So that's where the funding came in for the Carmichael location. Mm-hmm. And then we also got funding for, I think it was over COVID-19, it was relief during that tough period. You know, we wanted some relief because we wanted to keep our staff on and all of that. And so we got some funding through that period and we had some extra funds. And I took that to open our Prince Charles location in 2020. So each year, from 2018, in December, we opened a location. So it was Mount Royal 2018, Carmichael 2019, and Prince Charles 2020.
Wow.
Yeah. And so it's just basically, we've been expanding lately in terms of our product offering. And so, you know, we opened three locations by just selling cookies, you know, just cookies alone. But we realized that we need to diversify more, especially through the pandemic has shown us, you know, there's a need for diversification in our product offering because, you know, people were out of work for more than a year. And so they didn't have as much disposable income to splurge on, you know, sweets and stuff like that. And so if they had a choice between a place, you know, more than likely they can choose some food. And so we're looking to diversify mostly next year. We've already started. We started offering. We're still in the sweet category, but we started offering our homemade whipped ice cream last year.
Right.
We started offering fraps recently.
We started offering deli sandwiches recently.
Okay.
And so we're just looking to expand on more products to offer the public starting next year, because we're going to be actually closing our Mount Royal location this month, and actually in a matter of 10 days.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah. So Christmas Day is going to be, well, not Christmas Day, Christmas Eve. Well, there's a number of reasons. I think the location was good at the time, but now some things have changed with, businesses surrounding it and stuff. And so I'm not, fond of the location right now. And it's also parking is an issue. And it's a number of reasons.
Yeah.
And so it's a kind of scale back so that we can, redefine and redevelop our product offering. Mm-hmm. And we're going to do that mostly with our Carmichael location, because that's now our busiest foot traffic location. So we're going to, redefine what we offer now, get more diverse, and then we're going to look to expand after that. So this year is going to be a lot more development. We're going to also look into wholesale because we're actually in a lot of the schools, and so we're going to look more into wholesale markets, whether it be, smaller delis, cafes, restaurants, bars. If you own any of these establishments and you're looking to offer your customers something sweet when they come in, you can contact us, because we're looking to branch out more into the wholesale market in 2023. And then after that, we'll look more into expanding again, into opening new locations beyond that point.
Yeah, don't close Prince Charles.
No. Okay. Prince Charles and Carmichael will remain open. But Mount Royal, Christmas Eve will be the last day for Mount Royal to be open. Mm-hmm. And then we'll be down to the two locations, Prince Charles and Carmichael.
Okay. You mentioned the pandemic. But there are a lot of people, every time I went to Prince Charles, a lot of people in there. It seems like people needed the comfort of as you say, sweet things, cookies during the time.
When you lock up?
Huh? Yeah. Right? I don't know. I think there was a lot of people.
Well,
chose
actually,
cookies
yeah.
over the cooked food.
Well, throughout the pandemic, when we were allowed, to be open, people would come around. But like we started to see the foot traffic would go down like this year. Mm-hmm. So it's like the aftermath of the pandemic. You know what I mean? Because, people still had funds during the pandemic. But now the aftermath, when it really set in, you're trying to catch back up on your old stuff now.
Yeah.
We see it, go down just a little bit. But it started to pick back up towards the end of the year. Mm-hmm. But the first portion of this year was tough.
Yeah.
It was real rough.
Was inflation affected?
Oh, jeez. Now, see, you won't cost me guess. I ain't got no hair just up. But listen, inflation has been it's been ridiculous. It's like every other week, something has just been incrementally just increasing. I tell you this, most of our supplies that we make our, cookies and stuff with, compared to just earlier this year, most of our supplies cost at least twice as much.
My goodness.
At least twice as much.
And
some even more.
You're getting mostly here? Or?
Most of the things we buy is local.
Yeah.
And you could talk to any wholesaler, they'll tell you. It's like everything is almost twice as much as what we have paid. And so it's been tough because, only so high you want to go on your price.
Of course,
you want to try and remain competitive, and you also want to look out for your customers. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
So we haven't really... We just recently had a small increase in price last month. Mm-hmm. We didn't increase the prices at all this year, even through all of that inflation.
Right. Yeah.
And so the last price increase we had was last year, around August or September, I think. So this entire year, even through all of the crazy inflation, we didn't increase our prices, but it's getting so bad, we have to.
My goodness.
And so we just went up on some of the flavors. A lot of the flavors are still the same price, but we have some of the other flavors that just went up a little bit.
Yeah.
And so it's just, something that we have to do. Business owners, they're just greedy, they just want to make money, but they don't understand, especially in the food industry, your margins are already extremely slim. Mm. And so, you don't have a lot of margin for error when it comes to your pricing for your products. And so we do our best, but at the end of the day, we want to remain open.
And you're dealing with some products that are affected directly by the war, too.
Yeah, most definitely.
Yeah.
All right, so you mentioned flavors, and you said you start off with two, but you've got a whole lot more now.
Oh, yeah.
Tell us about that and how you come up with these flavors.
Well, it's not just one way. It's different ways. Like, sometimes I may see something. Like for s'mores, for example, I know people like s'mores. I've never seen a s'more cookie when I started to do it.
Yeah.
So I was like, that would be a cool idea to have a s'mores cookie, or even the red velvet. Like we introduced that, I think in 2013 in February, because, Valentine's.
Mm-hmm.
Red is the color for Valentine's. Yeah. So I was like, well, that would be cool to have a red velvet cookie.
Yeah.
And so that's how that came about. And then, as it pertains to our stuffed cookies, the first baker I ever hired, it was actually his idea. He just randomly, he was in the kitchen messing around, and he just made the guava cheesecake cookie and brought it out. And Tayson and I say, we got to put this on the menu. Various ways we come up with different flavors, whether it be from staff, whether it be from just seeing something on Pinterest or seeing a different treat, like the one of our stuffed cookies, the special stuffed cookie for December, which is the eggnog cream cheese stuffed ginger cookie.
My goodness.
Right?
That's a lot.
Saw that was Pinterest because I saw a cupcake. Someone had a ginger cupcake, and they had it stuffed with eggnog cream cheese.
Wow.
So I said, I should do that as a cookie. So we did that as a cookie, I think, for the first time maybe 2 years ago. And every December, that's our best-selling stuffed cookie, even
that's
more
than
the guava cheese.
That's a meal replacement cookie.
Yeah, well, it can be, yes, most definitely.
Yeah. The s'mores is my favorite, though. Have you had the s'mores?
I haven't had the s'mores.
Oh, my goodness gracious.
No, you ain't had s'mores?
That's amazing. I don't know what you're putting in that stuff.
That's plenty love, Dwight.
That's
plenty
dangerous.
Love.
Wow. Okay, so you talk about the expansion. So where do you see yourself in 3-5 years?
3 to 5 years. Like I said, once we get our new model down back, we're looking to expand, get a couple more locations in Nassau, then in Freeport, and then hopefully globally. Because we want to eventually become a franchise brand. And become one of the biggest, you know, food brands, not just in the Bahamas, but in the world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So amazing. Somebody's asking, where are you located on Prince Charles? Oh, they don't know.
On Prince Charles, that's right opposite the end of Doris Johnson. So in the Kenneth's Food Store Plaza, where Alive used to be. But it's right in the Kenneth's Food Store Plaza. And that's opposite the field part of Doris Johnson.
Yeah.
So right after you pass the King Perry Gord Shell gas station, it will be like a construction place right after them. And then we're the next plaza right after that.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, so let's take a break. When we come back, we're going to talk more about the businesses, and we'll go through the list of who else was who got awards with the MSME honors.
You have the
from
list?
The list? I do.
Oh.
They want me to read the list.
Oh, they want you to read
them. They're not here, but they want me to read the list. That's fine. That's fine. They're our good friends at A Squared SBDC. We'll be back. This is Morning Glen Business on Guardian Radio 96.9. Stay with us.
A local paper in Grand Bahama is back every Tuesday as a section of the Nassau Guardian. Available at local stores, gas stations, pharmacies, Western Bakery, and Bellevue Gifts. Daily and, of course, on Tuesdays too. Want to reach your Grand Bahama audience? Then call Barefoot Marketing at 827-4578 or message them for ad rates via their Facebook page. Advertising opportunities now include Latest Grand Bahama News in the Guardian newspaper every Tuesday.
Ready to save? You can put $100 into the CFAL Savings Express Plan and make sure your money keeps growing. Earn interest on your savings while you're sleeping, eating, or standing in line at the bank. Ready to invest? Start by putting $1,000 into our mutual funds and earn interest there too. Because at CFAL, your interest is our interest. Visit CFAL.com to start now. CFAL, growing wealth for future generations of Bahamians.
Know how important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services. From click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options, we're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Back here with Morning Glen Business on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strollo, Chester Robards on this Wednesday morning. We're talking with the MSME honorees, two of them, from the A Squared SBDC, the Access Accelerated Small Business Development Center. They had this was last month, right? Or earlier this month?
No, it was this day.
last month, because we just in December now.
It's December now.
Oh, I can't remember.
It was last month. 2 weeks ago.
It feels like maybe a week or two.
It was part of November. Small business.
Right, right, right.
So yeah, about a week or two.
So just a couple weeks ago. All right, so here are the other honorees for agriculture out of Freeport, Terrence Roberts. With education, Boost Academy, Jay Phoenix and Charlene Hansen Phoenix, who are often on the show. Mm-hmm. Fishing, Boardwalk Seafood Distributors, and Kurt Neely. And food and beverage, of course, Cookie Caterer, Gregory Colley. And transportation, Drive Green, Benjamin Davis. And also from tourism, Exuma Water Sports, Darren Clark. And professional services, Tiny Tots Organics, Valencia Ramming. So congratulations to everybody there. That's a good list there. All right. So we got a text here saying that Cookie Catering is to do a stuffed cookie with Bailey's and cream cheese. Or is it Bailey's cream cheese?
All right. That's that one on the board.
Yeah. We got maple.
Listen, I was thinking about that 2 days ago. So hey, listen, we have a lot
bacon?
Of...
Bacon?
Yeah, yeah. I literally was looking at options for that, like a day or two.
Oh.
Yeah, so we got a lot of stuff, a lot of ideas we want to explore in the new year. So yeah,
that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
All right. So Benjamin, got still a lot of people who are apprehensive about electric vehicles.
Who?
And I'm surprised.
Where they wrong?
But all of you are driving them. I'm the odd one out for now. But I'll catch you all up very soon.
See, he's one of them.
I'm not apprehensive, but just financially deficient. That's all. But we're going
to
deal with that.
You speaking directly to some people about that?
Anyway, but for those who are a little skeptical, what do you say to them?
I tell people, I said, listen, even if you're not driving an electric car for the environment, I say there's a couple other reasons you could drive it for. You could drive it for your wallet because you don't have to worry about people always ask me. They say, but electric cars are so much more expensive, so how does this business model even work for you? And I say, well, I think I save a lot on the maintenance. I don't have any transmissions to go out of, no oil leaks to worry about. I don't have, you know, so, you know, when it comes really to the maintenance, especially for our fleet, I mean, we do our inspections, but the most we have is we change our wiper blades, we change our tires, and the cars are right back on the road.
Yeah. People keep saying the battery, though, when that battery goes, it's going to be like a mortgage to replace that. What do you say to that?
You know, to people who say that, I said, you know, it's the same thing if the engine in your car was going to go.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if the battery is warranted for 8 years, you don't even get the same warranty. I think most of you buy it as a regular internal combustion engine ICE car. I think you get maybe, what, three years on the powertrain, 3 to 5 years on the powertrain.
I never had a new car, so I know.
So, and you know, if you were to, you know, blow a head gasket or you were to, you know, throw a rod through the side of the engine and you got to rebuild the engine or you now have to look for a new engine, you know, you're looking at the same price. And as technology is changing, the price of these batteries and replacements are going down. I think when electric cars first came out, when the Leaf first came out, if you wanted a replacement for a Leaf, I think the Leaf came out in 2013 or 2012, and if you needed to get a replacement for that, that would have probably cost about the same price of the car. But now if you needed a replacement for that, you're probably looking at less than, you know, $4,000 or $5,000. And it's the same thing, you know, you look at computers and you say, okay, what used to cost, you know, be a $2,000 computer 20 years ago or 10 years ago is now the same technology that they're putting on our smartwatches.
Yeah.
I mean, the when you look at how fast things are progressing, and which, of course, is why I think we also have this whole, you know, especially coming out of the pandemic, the whole chip shortage, we're just trying to get, you know, better and better. I mean, Apple has a new phone every year. You got new phones from Samsung. You got new technology that's coming up. I see them now putting technology back into, you know, the wearable glasses that now have the to your prescription glasses now and stuff like that. So, so if you're not driving it for, you know, the environmental factor, drive it for your wallet, save some money, or drive it for the fun. I always tell people, I said, electric cars are so fun to drive.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, you think of it as, you know, okay, this is just going to be like a golf cart. You can put your foot down and, you know, people blowing at you behind, hey, get out of the way, Grammy or whatever. Mm-hmm. But you basically, when you drive an electric car, you're almost faster than anything else on the road.
Yep.
You know, and if you have one of the higher models, or if you have something that has a bit more torque, I mean, you beat anything off the light. And, you know, one thing I hate about, you know, Bahamians being so notorious for running the red light is that when I'm to the front there, I can't just punch it. You know, I
somebody
gotta,
inevitably coming through.
Oh, yeah, that's
absolutely.
Right off.
So I got to wait there and I'm like, okay, coast is clear. And then I'd be like, okay, I'm on the drag strip. Because sometimes I want to be there, I'm like, you know, I feel like I'm a race car driver sometimes. So
yeah, the torque is...
Yeah, it's throws you back into the seat. It's a fun car to drive. Yeah. So, you know, you just got to get out there and try it. Even if I tell people, I said, you know, even if you just rent one for a day, I say, I always have people who will say, okay, I'm only going to rent it for a day. Just go back. Can I get an extension on this?
Ah,
or,
wow.
You know, this is so fun to drive or whatever the case is.
The only downside is when I jump in my car and it's on, I turn it off.
Yeah,
because I'm like, so quiet. I forget it's on.
I've done that many times.
Funny story about that. I've had people who have left the car on all day. I've had people who left the car on overnight. I had a call just the other day come in and I'm like, oh, what is this? I just dropped this car off. What do they call it? Because of course, anytime somebody gives you a call and you know it's a customer and it's after hours, it's like, oh, what has happened? I can't get the lights to turn off. I'm like, what do you mean? And she says, well, the switch is in the off position. I said, well, first of all, the lights are automatic, so you don't have to worry about that. Right. But she said, no, I put it in the off position, but the lights are still on. I said, well, you know, sometimes you have to, you know, lead the welcome home feature, so you like stay on for a couple of seconds. She said, no, it's been on for like 5 minutes. I said, okay, let me ask you something. Is the car switched off? She goes, hold on. she comes back to the phone a couple of seconds later. Yeah, sorry, I left the car on. So the daytime running lights, stayed on because she didn't turn the car on. Right, of course, you put it in park, you hop out, you don't hear anything, you don't feel anything. And so if you're, especially like for a first-time EV driver, it's a little unsettling sometimes. Yeah. You just don't realize it. Even when people turn it on and they're holding down the button, no, this car isn't working. It's not. I said, it's already on. You don't press the button once.
Right.
You know?
So it takes some getting used to. All right, so you were talking about this off air about the pandemic and the chip shortages and that the impact that's having. Tell us about that and what that's doing for your business there.
So anyone who's follows, I guess, the supply chain or has a company that has to work closely with either importing or getting things in knows that ever since coming out of the pandemic, there's been a shortage on a lot of things, and this isn't something that's only affected the Bahamas, but I mean, even companies even as big as Apple, I think they've gotten it sorted out now, but even companies as big as Apple have had to push back the launch of certain devices because they couldn't get chips. Car manufacturers inside the US and Europe have actually had to they've had cars sitting waiting to go. They're just waiting on one LCD screen, or they're just waiting on one module to connect the Bluetooth to the Ford Sync system, for example. And it's been a similar issue here, and it's just really about getting these cars imported. So a lot of times people call us and we say, we don't have any availability. And I, even coming up to the Christmas season, things were booked out, 6 weeks, 8 weeks in advance. And we're just now trying to get to the point where, can we get these cars in? Can we get the supplies for these cars? We have an issue with, we have a vehicle that we're trying to get back on the road so we can, meet these Christmas demands, and I just need some lower control arms, of course, with our potholes. That's usually so electric cars, some of the things they still have suspension. Regular suspension parts. So you could still bend up a rim, you could still break a tie rod in.
My goodness.
And so I'm looking for some control arms, and I spent 2 weeks just about looking through every supplier. And the thing is it's a Chevy. So I'm like, okay. We just got it in from South Florida 2 years ago. They should have these, a mile, everywhere. And they were on, what do they call it? National back order. I had to learn new terms and everything.
National back order.
So no Chevy dealership inside the U.S. could even get it. I finally got a hold of somebody who was able to actually say, I checked through the inventory. There's two dealerships on the whole country that actually have this part that's showing as in stock. So here are the numbers. I called them and they said, we have it in stock, but this is for one of our customers, and so we can't even sell this to you. And just been, and they're like, well, I said, well, why haven't they even been making it? And they're like, well, they're too busy trying to make everything else and trying to catch up on it. It just doesn't seem as an important part. So one control arm versus trying to get a whole, new car out of the factory line and everything, I think is still a bit, trying to catch up from after the pandemic. Even if you looked at a couple of the local dealerships here, you passed the lots 3 months ago, nobody had any cars on their lots.
I think finally trickling in.
I think that some of the boats just came in, so now I know quite a few of the dealerships now have cars on their lots actually for sale now. But 3 months ago, every lot was empty, or everything you saw was just either a used car or a car that didn't sell from 2018 or something like that. So just trying to get more cars on fleet so we can actually reach this demand.
That's wild. How long do you think it's going to last? What are you hearing? What are they saying?
That's something that I just don't know. I've reached out to one of the dealerships here, because I know the global brand started to do electric cars, and I said, let's see how quickly can you all get one of these in for me, because I said I'm really interested, even if not for a rental, I want one for myself, because I really, I've been following the company in the US for a while, and they said, you know, Benjamin, because I know the lady, she said, Benjamin, you know, I don't even think we can realistically get one of these into you. And this was last year, I asked her, until 2024. So basically, it was like a 3-year wait. And even inside the US, I mean, if you look at cars like the new electric ones, the Rivians that are coming up, you look at the Tesla Cybertruck, or even some of the new Tesla cars, even some of the new Chevy Bolts that we were looking at, there's like a year, 2-year wait on these cars. Yeah. And, you know, so this is US people trying to get them. So you imagine trying to get it exported. Right.
Yeah. This is crazy.
You just can't get your hands on the good stuff, seems like. So. Yeah.
So what will this mean for you in 5 years? What impact do you think that's going to have? And where do you see yourself if this gets resolved in about 5 years or so?
Well, we're always trying to expand. We're always looking at getting new vehicles. As long as we can meet the demand, it's about getting the new cars on, of course. And this is where, you know, companies like the SBDC, Access Accelerator, came in, because, of course, you look at a cash flow issue, and I'm sure Gregory would have had the same issue. When you're selling stuff that are $99 a day or that are $1.50 per cookie, and you're looking at, you know, buying a car that costs you $40,000 or buying a fridge that costs you $4,000, and you're only looking at $1.50 for a cookie, of course, you end up with a cash flow problem.
Yeah.
And this is where, you know, like the companies like SBDC come into. But in the same way that Gregory's looking to do bigger and better, we're doing the same thing. So we're expanding. People have been asking us, you know, why aren't you on, you know, some other family islands? This would be something that would be so cool on the family islands, especially for people who do ecotourism and stuff like that. And it's like, you know, right now we're trying to just, you know, we have this market that we're trying to, you know, before we can really, you know, look at branching out. We want to make sure that we do everything properly. We don't want to spread ourselves too thin to the point where, you know, we start to lose those core values that people love us for, you know, the customer service. Now people are calling us and we're like, you know, please hold. An available representative is going to get to you in 1 hour.
Right.
So, so, you know, people call us, we answer, email us, you answer. So we're looking at the same type of thing. So we're looking at getting more cars. We want to get... really, the main goal is really we want to get into the airport. We've been doing everything really online so far. So we have our, you know, people book us on, you know, Kayak, Expedia, you know, TripAdvisor. So you look at a couple of these different booking channels as well. But I think nothing beats having that you know, physical presence as well. So for those of us, you know, persons who didn't get a chance maybe to look on Expedia beforehand, but if they're going to walk past the airport and they can say, whoa, I could actually get an electric car for, you know, let me check this out.
Yeah.
So, you know, something like that I think would really be, you know, cool as well. And that's something that we're, you know, looking into in the next, definitely within 5 years.
Excellent, excellent. All right, so Gregory, what advice would you give to entrepreneurs out there listening to this and inspired by your story, by Benjamin's story? What would you tell them? With their business, their idea, their plan?
Well, the thing I always tell people is just make sure you have to do self-evaluation first and realize that this is something that you really want to do and are passionate about, because you're going to go through some rough, tough times, and that's the only thing that's going to get you through those times, that passion and that drive and that desire to do it. Yeah. A lot of people are looking at entrepreneurship now because it's a trend now. Mm-hmm. It's a hard thing. We do social media, you know, everybody is an entrepreneur now, you know what I mean? And so it looks like the trendy thing to do. Entrepreneurs becoming more popular than some of these rappers. And so it's like everybody
on Instagram is a fitness trainer.
Yeah. I mean, some form of entrepreneurship is on Instagram. Everybody have a business, right? Don't do it just because it's a trendy thing and quick money. You have to really be driven to do this, and it has to be within you. At least that's my belief. Yeah. You know what I mean? Because it's always been in me. I mean, I've worked before, but I've always had that, you know, thing in my gut to want to do my own thing and have my own business. And so that's the first thing you need to do. And once you recognize that, just stick with it. You know what I mean? Stay like... Benjamin said something that was very important. You got to stick to your core principles because you can easily get sidetracked or thrown off course due to certain circumstances, but you have to remain true to your core principles and values throughout. And that's how you keep your customer base and grow your customer base. Yeah. And so that's what advice that I would give. And also, I mean, you could try it. Even if you don't feel like, you know, it's deep in your core, I mean, you could still try. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Give it a shot, because you don't want to regret not giving it a try. You don't want to one thing you don't want to go to the grave with is regret. You could go with failure is fine, you know. Failure is just a lesson learned. But if you have that regret, that's the worst feeling you could have in the world, that what if. what if? And you're just wondering your whole life. So give it a shot. I mean, if it doesn't work, then it doesn't work. But at least you knew you gave it your best shot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Benjamin, what about you? What advice would you give entrepreneurs out there?
I think Gregory hit the nail on the head right there.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I could not have said that any differently. I almost had the exact same words I said. You know, you have to just basically, you just have to, you have to do it. Recently, I just launched another company, a selfie studio that we just opened up a couple of weeks ago. Mm-hmm. And I, you know, did an interview about a week or so ago about that, and they asked
what
me the same
it,
thing.
Selfie?
Yeah, it's Bahama Selfie Studio. Okay. It's in the Independence Business Park with Duncan right on E Street. Mm. And, you know, the whole, it's a, once again, it's a new idea. It seemed like I always thought we want to do these things first, I guess, and see if it works. Mm-hmm. And I told the interviewer, I said, you know, I just had to do it for, I saw the concept in the US. I looked at the business plan. I made it out. I looked, I found a space. I said, you know something, I think this could work. And I sat on it for a couple of months and I said, I'm not going to do it. And I said, yeah, I probably should. And then one day I woke up and I just said, you know something, I have to do it, because I know that next year at the same time, if I didn't do it, I'd have been like, you know something, I should have done it. Or, you know, is somebody else going to do it? And I said, boy, you know something, that could have been me. Mm-hmm. And those are the kind of things that keep me up at night. I mm-hmm. never want to live with regret. I never want to be able to say, boy, you know, I wish I'd done this when I was 20, or I wish I had done this last year. So, and I think that's something that maybe that entrepreneurs, you know, share in common. We see something, we say, you know, something, we got to do it. Yeah. And it is a risk. But one thing we learn in business school is that it's a calculated risk. Mm-hmm. That's the operative word there, calculated. Yeah. So yes, at the end of the day, you know, your plan may not come out exactly as how it was supposed to be. But, you know, you say, you know, I've done all of these different things. I've done all of these different scenarios, and I know that, you know, there's a high certainty that I'll be fine. And that's something that SBDC does well. You know, you go through all these different rounds. You go through all these different things with your advisors, and you have all these different people whose job literally it is just to poke holes in your plan.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
And
yep.
make you think about things that you may not have thought about. Mm-hmm. You know, one of the questions I think that always came up with me, and this is why we ended up, shifting the model a little bit, because when we first went through it, they said, but what if you can't get these hotels on board? Mm-hmm. And, you know, and it, I will be honest, it was a challenge to get, especially when you have, you know, the bigger names who, mm-hmm. you know, you almost can't even talk to somebody, yeah, you know, mm-hmm. up there, because, you know, you're such a small fry just trying to start out. Mm-hmm. And that's why, you know, we ended up shifting the business model a little bit and say, okay, well, and since we, it's so, you know, proven a little tricky to get out of these hotels and we're on a time crunch, what if we try to get the smaller places, like, you know, the restaurants, the entertainment complexes, the plazas? So, I mean, obviously there's some hotels that are listening to this and they say, well, if we want an electric charging station for our guests, then, you know, feel free to reach out to us and we'll definitely, you know, make that happen. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I try to, you know, get it to the point where a person's able to say, you know, we make it easy and we say, okay, we're going to give you the charger. And, you know, only thing you have to do is just cover the electricity. And now you're listed on our website. You're listed on, you know, all these different partner websites as well.
Yeah.
But like I say, the key thing is just get it done. And even if you have to, you know, reach out to somebody who says, you know, maybe I have a friend who did business, or I have somebody else who is a business. I'm speaking for myself, and I'm sure Gregory's the same. But when we have people that come in and they say, you know, I want a hand with this, or can you help me with something. I've had people who, you know, friends, I've had colleagues, I've had people who've reached out to me, family members, and say, hey, I have somebody who's interested in starting something. Mm-hmm. Would you mind, you know, mm-hmm. helping them out, even nice. If it's for a fee? And I said, you know, I'm not going to charge anyone for this. Yeah. I, you know, come to me if you're serious and, you know, you have a plan where you could talk about this. Mm-hmm. And basically, you know, if I can help somebody else be the next entrepreneur, if I can help somebody else do reach their dreams, then I'm all for that. So reach out to people who are in business or who may have done something mm-hmm. similar. And just, you know, make that first step. Yeah. And once you make that initiative, you're good.
Excellent. Okay, really running out of time. How can people reach you and find out more about Drive Green Rentals?
So we're on the web. You can actually book us directly online, drivegreenrentals.com. If you want to search us on Kayak, Expedia, you can do that as well. I'm not sure what the prices may be if you book not directly, but you can also just reach us at 242-809-0020 or our US line, 813-566-1848.
Okay, wonderful. And Gregory Colley?
Awesome.
Where can people reach you? How tell us all those details.
CookieGator.com. You can Google the Cookie Gator, but we have our website, CookieGator.com. You can order through the website. We encourage people to order through the website because we're actually going cashless with deliveries next year.
Wow. Okay.
And so deliveries, we won't be doing any more cash on deliveries. And so you're going to have to order through the website. Mm-hmm. You can pay on the website and we bring the cookies or whatever it is that you order right to you. And like I said, we have, currently three locations. That's Mount Royal Avenue, 161 Mount Royal Avenue until, Christmas Day. Mm-hmm. And then we have Carmichael Road. That's building number 191. Right at the intersection where the Milo Butler Highway meets Carmichael Road, right there by the traffic light. And then, like we said earlier, Prince Charles Drive and Kenneth's Food Store Plaza, right opposite Doris Johnson. Mm-hmm. Come on out, visit any of our locations. We have our holiday flavors for the rest of the month, which I brought you guys today. I brought you a taste of
these are just for show, right?
Yeah, okay. Well, you know, I can't come empty-handed, so I brought you some of our holiday flavors. We have our Christmas sugar. We have our winter ginger cookie. We also have our eggnog snickerdoodle.
Oh, wow.
And then the one I spoke about earlier, the eggnog cream cheese stuffed ginger, we actually have in this package also.
Oh, right.
So these cookies are only available for the next, 10 days for the rest of December, so make sure I come out, or like I said, go to our website, Cookie Gator Gone.
Excellent.
Awesome.
You guys are an inspiration. Thank you so much for being here this morning, and congratulations to you both and to all the honorees. And Gregory Colley with Cookie Caterer and Benjamin Davis with Drive Green Rentals, thank you for talking with us this morning.
Thank you.
It's been a pleasure.
Appreciate it. Yes. And thank you to A Squared SBDC. And we'll talk with them in a couple of weeks. But thank you again. Appreciate it.
Thank you. All right.
Chester Robards, that's it for us today.
Oh, it's a pleasure.
I'll be back tomorrow morning with more Morning Blend business right after Morning Blend right here on Guardian Radio 96.9. Stay tuned for Aaron Green and On the Clock next.
Forty on the brakes, a new and glorious morn.